patience and skill keeps villains at bay, and she's never afraid to leap in and lead the fight. When her DNA was
you know, that's what a typical kid would do, is you watch a movie and then you do the role play to be that character.
Yeah, yeah. So she is often doing that, and sometimes we don't even realize that she's citing quotes from movies when it sort of has meaning to her or fits into a situation. And then later on, maybe I'll realize, oh yeah, that was something that someone said in a movie.
You took us to that scene in the hospital when Zora was first born. Michaela was just 2 years old, holding her new little sister, sitting in the chair. How did the two of them get along now?
That's a great question. I think she loves being a big sister. They play really well together, but they often compete as well, like most siblings do. They will often fight a lot together in a, you know, a sibling way. One of the things that I think frustrates Michaela is that, you know, Zora is 6 years old and Michaela is eight. And to some extent, Zora is a little more trustworthy. You know, she can go outside and we know that we can trust Zora to like follow the rules. Whereas that's something that Michaela is still learning to do reliably. She can go outside for a little bit, but then we have to kind of be out there keeping an eye on her. And so she's starting to recognize that Zora has a little more independence than she does. And that is definitely a source of frustration, I think. There's a certain way in which parenting right now is just so mundane. Three kids, 6, 8, and 10, and they're all learning to be people, learning how to deal with stress and frustration and making friends and the challenges that come along with school and things like that. She's in no way exempt. Right now, we're just in this mode of like, she goes to elementary school, she takes the bus in the morning, she's in gymnastics and in dance and doing all the things that a typical 8-year-old does. Michaela's younger sister, Zora, she's starting to see that sometimes Michaela needs more guidance or structure, and we've had to talk to Zora about that. But it's interesting because I don't think they really, at this point, it's not something that they're constantly thinking about. They don't view her through that lens necessarily. I'm curious to see what that will mean to them as they become older, and then at what point Michaela will begin to self-identify through those terms.
From episode to episode here on Constant Wonder, our quest often leads us to stories that convey the wonder and the beauty of humans being humane in this very imperfect world. For today, with this particular guest and this particular story, we're going to leave things right there at what is necessarily an inconclusive juncture in the story. After all, Michaela is young and has a whole life ahead of her yet. As Tom just described her, she's on the brink of coming to see herself on her own terms, yes, but also coming to see herself in a world that all too often will set terms for others. Tom says he's curious to see how Michaela grows through all of this. I've got a feeling that with parents like Tom and Tiffany, she's going to develop a healthy self-concept. She'll know how much she means to others and what the people she loves mean to her. Thomas Pearson is an anthropology professor at the University of Wisconsin-Stout. He's author of An Ordinary Future, Margaret Mead, The Problem of Disability and a Child Born Different. Today's episode was produced by Eric Schultzka with help from Brian Barba. Sound design was by James Kahn. Thanks for being with us. I'm Marcus Smith. Constant Wonder is a production of BYU.
All right, hello, hello.
Hello?
Hi there, who's on the board?
Next week on Constant Wonder, we'll speak with a man who adopted a scraggly Eastern screech owl chick. He named her Alfie.
Hi, Soraya. Do we have anybody else today?
Brought her back from the edge of death, raised her to
adulthood.
Maya will
be here.
Maya will be here.
Released her into the wild. And then continued to
okay.
Park her life in a way.
Right.
She had
I don't hear
used.
You very well over
Alfie
program. I could use a little less program, a little more you on the mix.
But what about her mate? Well,
okay, sounds good.
Was less
okay.
Fond of the intruding human.
Bom, bom,
and
bom.
Once those chicks were out of the nest, he was very aggressive. He would buzz
okay,
me, threatening, flapping,
by.
And they fly completely silently. So if they're not screaming and clacking at you.
No anthem today, so we'll start right with
coming.
Me.
And one time, he wanted to make a
okay.
point. He silently came full speed and slammed me in the side of the head. You know, it freaked me out. I have to say, it was, you know, to not have any inclination that he was coming, it rattled me. But the first mate never did anything like that.
We'll also be visiting with a man who ventured into the deepest wilderness of Siberia in pursuit of a fish owl, the world's largest owl. Trapping and tagging that owl for study took some out-of-the-box thinking. No spoilers here, but I can tell you, it involved fish, buckets, and cross-country skis. We'll be bringing you a pair of the most improbable stories, and we hope you will join with us next Wednesday. Thanks for being with us today for Constant Wonder. And if you like what you've heard, be sure to give us a 5-star rating wherever you get your podcasts. I'm Marcus Smith. Constant Wonder is a production of BYU Radio.
Faith is openness to God and loyalty and sense of connection.
All right, 1 minute.
Knowledge is intimacy.
I felt intrinsically that I had a hole inside of me where religion was supposed to go.
On In Good Faith, we believe that all faith traditions have something to teach us about how God is working in the world and in our lives. So join us to listen, learn, and be amazed. Sunday on BYU Radio and the In Good Faith podcast.
BYU Radio comes to you in more ways than ever. Nationwide, we're heard on Sirius XM Satellite Radio on channel 143. Ask your smart speakers for BYU Radio. Stream us worldwide at byuradio.org. And in Utah, you can get us on HD Radio at 89.1 KBYU FM HD2 Provo. And on the FM dial at 107.9 KUMT Randolph Ogden Salt Lake Provo. BYU Radio.
The following is a presentation of the New Skin, BYU Sports Network. This is BYU Cougars Baseball.
Hammers that, and that's a no-doubter, a three-run shot.
Live coverage of BYU Baseball is brought to you by doTERRA. doTERRA, proud sponsor of the BYU baseball team. Now, for all the action, here's the voice of the Cougars, Greg Rubel.
Go.
Good afternoon, Cougar baseball fans. A little earlier than originally scheduled. Welcome back inside Larry H. Miller Field at Miller Park on the BYU campus here in Provo, Utah, as today the Cougars open a key conference series with the visiting Kansas Jayhawks in this Thursday matinee. BYU and KU were scheduled for a 6 o'clock start tonight. But with worse weather in the forecast for later, we're hoping to get this one in early, then see what the weekend holds in store for games 2 and 3. I'm Greg Rubel. I've got your play-by-play today with first pitch just around the corner. Let's hear from BYU head coach Trent Pratt in our leadoff interview presented by doTERRA. doTERRA, pursue what's pure. And Coach Pratt today setting up the stakes for a series pitting teams currently part of a 5-way tie for 7th in the Big 12 at 4-5.
Yeah, and they're all big.
Clear.
Thank you.
You know, so we're just, it's another weekend, and, you know, weather's playing a factor, so we just got to make sure we're ready to play. And that's the biggest thing is, you know, it might change. Time is going to change, but we'll get ready to play. But definitely a big series this weekend, and our guys know that, and, you know, ready to bounce back for Monday.
We did move things up a few hours to get this one in for sure. We're always keeping an eye on the weather in March. It's just kind of one of those things, like, flexibility has to be your hallmark.
Yeah, a lot of good things about Utah, but weather in March isn't one of them. So we just watch it, and like I said, we can't control it. That's what we tell our guys. We can't do anything about when rain comes in or what happens. All we can do is make sure when they say it's time to play that we're ready. So that's our biggest focus today.
The two starters, both guys who can get 7 solid innings in.
Yeah, Don's here, and Bryce are really good. So yeah, we're for a good baseball game today. Don's a manufacturer, so he's doing well.
Most about your team's performance in league series so far?
I think we competed real well. We've got to find a way to be more consistent at the plate on the mound, you know, on the second and third day, and just, you know, just
30.
There. But I feel like we're right in the mix and not knowing, kind of not knowing what's coming in the Big 12. I feel like we performed well and, you know, had chances to maybe, you know, take another series, but, you know, last weekend, but didn't do it, so ready to regroup this weekend, try to get it done.
And you get to play on big league opening day, a lot of baseball in the air today.
Yeah, a lot. So I kind of forgot it was big league opening day. Looking at the weather all day yesterday, trying to figure what's happening today. I forgot about that.
5 mics are hot.
It's an exciting day.
All right, Coach, good luck in this one. We'll talk to you first game.
All right, that is BYU head coach Trent Pratt. Time now for today's starting lineups, courtesy of Big O Tires. Stop by your locally owned and operated Big O Tires location. Big O Tires, the team you trust. For the Kansas Jayhawks, leading off and playing center field, number 29, John Nett. Hitting second, the second baseman, number 18, Cody Shojinaga. Hitting third, the DH, number 52, Lenny Ashby. Hitting cleanup, the catcher, number 21, Jake English. Hitting fifth, the first baseman, number 25, Ben Hartle. Hitting sixth, the shortstop, number 7, Collier Cranford. Hitting seventh, number 6, the third baseman, Michael Brooks. Hitting eighth, the right fielder, number 9, Luke Lido. And hitting ninth, number 42, the left fielder, Chase Jans. Starting pitcher for the Jayhawks. We'll see him shortly. Number 31, Reese Dutton. 5-1 on the year, and he's won his last 5 starts. More on Dutton coming up. For BYU, leading off and playing left field, number 11, Luke Anderson. Hitting second and playing second, number 5, Crew Robinson. Hitting third, the third baseman, number 17, Easton Jones. Hitting cleanup, the DH, number 33, Kuhio Aloy. Hitting fifth, the first baseman, number 7, Cooper Vest. Hitting sixth, the right fielder, number 13, Bryker Herdsman. Hitting seventh, the catcher, number 10, Parker Goff. Hitting eighth and playing center field, number 26, Keone Painter. Hitting ninth and playing shortstop, number 21, Chipper Beck. And BYU starting pitcher to open this key Big 12 weekend is number 37, Ben Hansen. Big Ben, 3-2 on the year with a 5.58 ERA. Leads BYU in innings pitched with 30 2/3 coming into today, as Dutton leads the Jayhawks in innings pitched at 35 coming into this afternoon's game. All right, BYU and KU, both teams playing their 23rd games of the season. BYU coming in 11-11, KU coming in 12-10, but in league again. In Big 12, these teams are tied for 7th in the standings with records of 4-5. Today's game was to go at 6. We're at 1 o'clock. And then tomorrow we're scheduled for 6 and Saturday for 1, but the weather's looking a little squirrelier on Saturday more than tomorrow, so tomorrow would be in play for a doubleheader if the forecast gets gloomy enough. That's a possibility. Again, nothing set and likely wouldn't be till later today into tonight, but right now we're set for 6 tomorrow, 1 Saturday. Weather pending is the best way to put it. Kansas coming into today, having won the opener of its last 3, or its last 5 conference, last 5 series, last 3 in league. So their first 3 conference series have all begun with an opening win. Those have been Friday wins. This one, of course, a Thursday. In fact, most of the league is on a Thursday-Saturday schedule this weekend. Usually it's just BYU and its opponents playing the Thursday, Friday, Saturday games. But it's Easter weekend, and so the Big 12 has most of its teams on a Thursday to Saturday slate today. All right, head coach of the Jayhawks is Dan Fitzgerald in his second year. Third base coach for KU will be Tyler Hancock and Scott Junk at first. Kansas in the very attractive powder blue uniforms with darker blue numbers, royal caps, powder jerseys and pants, and the script says Jayhawks diagonally in cursive across the chest in red and white lettering. All right, ready to play. BYU and KU, 1:06 p.m., 51 degrees, and a wind out of the south-southwest at 11 miles per hour, gusting to near 20. Ben Hansen, the right-hander, kicks and deals and delivers a called first strike. 93-mile-per-hour fastball from Ben Hansen to get this one underway, and it's 0-1 to John Nett, the center fielder. Right-handed hitting, John Nett. Fouls out of play down the first baseline, so Ben gets into an early advantageous count at 0-2 to Nett. Nett hitting 314 coming in two today. 7 doubles, a triple, looking for his first home run of the year. The 0-2. Hansen kicks and fires and delivers a chase pitch high and away. Fastball at 95 outside. 1-2, the count to Nett. Has started all 23 games now this year as the center fielder. We'll see him in center shortly. The 1-2. And a swing and a miss, and the first batter of the game goes down on strikes. A forward K, John Nett is down with a strikeout and one gone here in the top of the first. Ben Hansen, primarily 3-pitch mix, fastball, and the low to mid 90s slider, and the high 70s to low 80s, and a change in the same vicinity. Second consecutive right-handed hitter stepping into the box, Cody Shojinaga, the second baseman, the Jayhawks batting average leader. And fouls that off the plate back to the backstop, 0-1, so Ben gets ahead again. In Big 12 play, Shojinaga is the hits and doubles leader. The 0-1. Low and away. Fastball missing beneath the frame, 1-1 the count. On the Jayhawks, Shojinaga is the batting average and hits and doubles and total bases leader. Opposite field into the right field corner. It will be just foul. About 3 yards wide of the line in the right field corner. So 1-2 the count goes on the foul from Cody Shojinaga. Shojinaga, last year's co-freshman of the year in the Big 12. Steps into a 1-2 count. Cool gray day here along the Wasatch Front. Ben Hansen working first base side of the rubber. Wind up and delivery, and that's in the dirt. Away from the right-handed hitting Shojinaga. Count goes to 2-2. It's a fastball at 89 from Ben. Hansen coming in with a 5.58 ERA. Batters hitting 248 against him coming into the day. The 2-2. And that's off the fist foul down the third baseline. Count will stay at 2-2. Fourth Big 12 series for both teams. And again, KU's won the series opener in all three league series so far. The 2-2. Matt's in the dirt. Lone away fills the count at 3-2. BYU in the all whites today, jerseys and pants. Brigham in cursive and Young, the word Young in the tail of the M. Diagonally across the chest. Navy caps for the Cougs. A 3-2. That's in tight, and he walked him. So Shojinaga will take his base with one gone here in the top of the first. And the BYU pitching staff really struggled with the free passes on Monday. BYU pitchers walked 12 Wolverines and hit 6 of them. 18 free bases issued on Monday. Left-handed hitting Lenny Ashby, the DH, now digs in with one out and one on, top one. Scoreless game, and he lashes that opposite field. Fouled out of play down the third baseline, 0-1 to Ashby. Ashby coming in two today on a 5-game streak of reaching base, but at the same time, he's in a hitting rut, 2 for his last 30. The 0-1, and that is ripped and just foul. It's about 3 feet foul down the right field line, 0-2. Ben gets ahead of Ashby. So while Ashby's in that hitting slump, he has walked 5 times in the last 4 games. So finding a way to get on base, but not doing so via the hit. Again, 2 for his last 30, 1 RBI in his last 9 games. The 0-2 from Hansen to Ashby. And that's barreled well right at Bryker Herdsman. Catches that dipper around the knees, and that'll be 2 gone. So solidly hit, but right at Herdsman. And a good adjustment there, just stepping in a step or two and catching it around the kneecaps. 2 gone as Ashby is retired to right. We'll bring up the catcher, Jake English. English seeing it well, hits in 7 of his last 9 coming in 2 today. Fastball past the swinging English at 93. 0-1 the count from Hansen. Shojinaga on first with a 1-out walk. Nat struck out. Shojinaga walked. Ashby flies out to right field. 2 gone, top 1, scoreless game. That's fastball high. Count even at 1-1. Jake English looking for a hit in his 5th consecutive game. The 1-1 to English. That's barreled deep to left, and Luke Anderson's going to watch that one go into the pines. A 2-run shot here in the top of the first, and KU takes the 2-0 lead, a two-out, two-run home run from Jake English, his seventh of the season. The Jayhawks open on top. KU 5-2 this year when they score in the first inning, and the Jayhawks have scored in the first inning. They're also 9-3 when scoring first, and the Jayhawks have scored first in this one. So 2-0 KU, two runs on one hit. That was walloped to left, just left the 380 sign. Seventh for English, and the next batter's hit. Ben Hartle gets plunked on the arm, and so Ben Hansen, after getting two out with one on, sees the base is cleared and then puts another aboard as he hits Hartle. And so BYU's walks and hit-by-pitch issues from Monday rear their ugly head early on Thursday. Collier Cranford, the shortstop, out of the six hole, is the sixth batter here in the first inning. Off-speed layoff, but a called strike one from home plate umpire Christopher Griffith. Griffith behind the plate. Matt McKendry at first, Doug Williams at second, Joshua Nolan at third. That's your arbiter crew today. The 0-1 to Cranford. And that will be fair down the third baseline into the left field corner. Extra bases for Cranford. Rounding third and coming home is Hartle. He will slide head first ahead of the throw. And it's 3-0 Kansas with a double for Cranford, an RBI double. And the Cougs in an early spot of trouble so early that Abe Alvarez coming out of the dugout for a mound visit. So Parker Goff will join Abe Alvarez on the hill and chat with Hansen, who's down 3-0 early. Strike out of net, Shojinaga a base on balls. Ashby flies out, then an English two-run home run, a Hartle hit by pitch, and now Cranford with a two-bagger that brings home Hartle with KU's third run here in the top of the first. 3-0 Kansas. Three runs on two hits, still two out, and a runner in scoring position for Michael Brooks, the third baseman, hitting in the seventh spot. And Brooks gets a hold of that one, a one-hopper to Luke Anderson, comes up firing as Cranford comes home, and he will slide ahead of the throw. Advancing on the overthrow to home is Brooks. Another run scores, 4-0 Jayhawks, and Brooks finds himself at second base. And the eighth batter in the top of the first, Luke Lido, will step in. 4-0 KU, four runs on three hits. Give Brooks a single with an advance on the throw. So two-run home run for English, then RBI double for Cranford, RBI single for Brooks, 4-0 Kansas. The left-handed hitting Lido against the righty Ben Hansen, and Ben delivers low for ball one, and we're going to see bullpen activity already here in the top of the first. The 1-0 to Lido. KU has the early lead here at Miller Park. Two balls, no strikes. The fastball missing up top to Lido. He's on a six-game streak of reaching base coming in two today. Waggles the bat over his left shoulder and took the barrel off and held back on a called strike at 92 from Ben Hansen. So two balls and a strike. Runner in scoring position is Brooks on second. The 2-1. Check swing foul to the backstop. Two balls, two strikes. Ben coming in two today with a long outing of six innings. It came in his last outing. A whip of 1.53, a strikeout to walk ratio of 1.35. His high pitch count, a buck 05, 105 pitches for his high on the year. The 2-2, two out, one on. The man on second is Brooks, 4-0 KU. And a swing and a miss. Second swinging strikeout of the inning. So the inning begins and ends with a swinging strikeout, but in between all kinds of trouble. And Kansas scores four runs on three hits. There were no errors, and one was left on. We go bottom one, KU 4, BYU 0 on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
At Smith's,
Clear.
Our fresh produce to meet your expectations. And to make sure a bad apple won't spoil the whole bunch, we're dedicated to doing a 24/7 inspection on our fruits and veggies, checking for things like color, quality, making sure you only get the freshest apples. In fact, only the best produce like juicy pears, zesty oranges, and crisp carrots reach our shelves. Because when it comes to fresh, our higher standards mean fresher produce. Smith's, fresh for everyone.
This song doesn't have a name, but if it did, it'd probably be something about togetherness, because it's a collaboration, not between pop stars and producers, but between music therapists and kids. Music therapy is a treatment that doesn't involve medication or meds, and it's been proven to help children manage pain and contribute to faster healing. So it shouldn't surprise you, it's our favorite song. And just one way we partner with you for a life well lived.
BYU Big Stories covers the amazing tales surrounding BYU's opponents. Austin native Tyler Campbell, son of Texas Longhorns football legend Earl Campbell, talks about why his father discouraged him from playing football.
He said, "Are you sure you want to drink that cup? He's like, are you sure that's what you want? I know your friends want to do it, but are you sure that's your top?"
10.
Details football's difficult road and becoming the first college football player with MS. All episodes of Big Stories are on the BYU Radio app or wherever you listen to podcasts.
For more Cougar baseball, let's rejoin Greg Bubel.
Go.
Kansas scores 4 in the top of the first, staking Reese Dutton to a comfortable lead. We go bottom one, and Luke Anderson will start things off for the Cougs. Anderson, Robinson, Jones, 1-2-3 here in the bottom of the first. Anderson, the left fielder, BYU's batting average and hits and runs and walks and stolen bases leader. You can also tack on doubles to that tally as well. Luke doing it all out of the leadoff spot. Luke hitting 349 on the year. Takes a healthy hack at the fastball from Dutton for strike one. Reese Dutton, 5-1 with a 2.57 ERA. 35 innings pitched, making his seventh appearance at seventh start. Right-hander breaking ball. Opposite field from Luke Anderson. It'll get down to the right field corner. Luke rounding first, digging hard for two, and will slide in head first with a leadoff double. So BYU's doubles leader, Luke Anderson, with his sixth two-bagger of the year. And the Cougs put a runner in scoring position for Crew Robinson. So Luke aboard with a double to right field. Crew with hits in 6 of his last 7 games. He was tied with Luke Anderson for the lead in doubles this year until seconds ago when Luke lashed his 6th double to the right field corner. Runner in scoring position for Crew. Left-handed hitting Crew Robinson up the middle. Off the shortstop. Didn't handle cleanly and no throw to first as the second baseman Shojinaga took it off the ricochet. And so likely going to be an E6 on that one. First and second for BYU as Crew Robinson reaches. See how they score that. It was a hot shot to second. The shortstop ranging over, Collier Cranford didn't handle it cleanly. They will call it an E6. So a double for Anderson, an E6 reach for Robinson. And that's for Easton Jones with a runner in scoring position and two aboard, no one out. Bottom one, 4-0 Jayhawks. But the Cougars looking to cut into that deficit early. Easton Jones hitting .338, slugging .613. BYU's slugging percentage leader. Time for the team lead with Diggers with 6 as well. Takes a look on an inside off speed for ball one. 1-1 the count to Jones. Jones has reached base in the last 4 games. KU 4 runs on 3 hits, top one. We're bottom one now. BYU no runs, a single hit, and an E6 creating first and second for Jones with no one out. Dutton fires. Fastball low and away. Ball two, 1 strike to Jones. Dutton's long outing of the year, 7 innings. That came in his last outing. A whip of 1.09. A strikeout-to-walk ratio of nearly 3 at 2.82. He, like Hansen, has gone 105 for his high-pitch outing, and that'll be fouled to the screen by Jones, evening the count at 2-2. BYU Baseball brought to you by doTERRA, proud sponsor of the BYU baseball team. Just underway, a chilly gray day here in Provo. Flag hanging limp in center field for the moment. 4-0 Jayhawks, first inning. And Jones waits and then take a healthy hack through strike three. So Jones down on strikes. First strikeout of the day for Reese Dutton. D.H. Cujillo Aloy now steps in, hitting cleanup. He's tied with Easton Jones for the home run lead at six. He's BYU's RBI leader. Had a grand slam last weekend in Lubbock. So one out, two on, and BYU down four, bottom one. First pitch delivered up top for ball one. Cujillo takes his distinctive crouch, the right-handed hitting DH, facing the righty Dutton. Kicks and deals, and nice pitch on the outside edge of the frame. That came into the mid-80s. Called strike one, one and one the count. One gone, two on for BYU, bottom one. Dutton brings his glove to his chest, glances back at second, winds and deals, and delivers low and away. Count goes to two and one. Three-pitch mix for Dutton. Fastball, slider, change. Fastball topping out around 93. Change in the mid-80s and slider low 80s. Does like his breaking stuff. It tends to be his wipeout pitch as well. When he gets two strikes on a batter, he's got one on Aloy right now. Two balls and a strike is stepping off and fainting towards second is Dutton. Transfer from USC Upstate. Breaking ball swung on and foul back out of play by Aloy. At USC Upstate last year, pitched more than 90 innings in 15 starts. And like is the case this year, a nearly 3-1, or better than 3-1 strikeout to walk ratio last year. And has won his last five starts coming into today. Light drizzle falling now here in Provo. And that's the second swinging strikeout of the inning for Dutton. As waving at the off-speed offering is Aloy. Back-to-back strikeouts for Dutton and the Jayhawks. And so BYU putting the first two batters aboard, no one out. Now has two aboard and two out for Cooper Vest. We're going to see an infield shift here. Shoji Naga is going over to third. And Brooks is going to move over to second with Cranford staying at short. So the second and third baseman have traded places here for Cooper Vest, left-handed hitting. And they're putting the second baseman in the hole as Vest gets hit and loads the bases with two gone here in the bottom of the first. So Cooper Vest takes an HBP to first base. Anderson will go to third, and Robinson to second. So bases loaded for Bryker Herdsman. So Cooper Vest just hit by a pitch, and BYU's HBP leader in Bryker Herdsman steps in. He's been plunked seven times to lead the Cougs this year. Two gone, and bases loaded for BYU trailing 4-0. A tying run comes to the plate as Herdsman takes strike one on the breaker. Bases loaded, two out. BYU with the bases loaded this year, hitting 314, 11 for 35 with the sacks stacked. The 0-1 to Herdsman, the center, the right fielder today. Dutton winds and fires, and he gets into an 0-2, a head count on Herdsman as Herdsman waves at the off-speed breaker away. 0-2, Breaker's in a hole. And Dutton's got his options in front of him here, working third base side of the rubber. Dutton winds and fires, and holding back is Herdsman. They appeal, and no dice at first. That breaker away from Herdsman creates a 1-2 count. Luke Anderson leadoff double. Crew Robinson reaching on an E6 first and second, but then Jones and Aloy, two good bats, each strikeout swinging, bringing up Cooper Vest, who was hit, and now bases loaded for Herdsman in a 1-2 count. Goes to 2-2. Mid-80s, low and away from Dutton. K KU in the Powder Blues and BYU in the Whites with Navy today. Parker Goff is on deck. He's got the catcher's pads on, though, ready to go if he's needed. Sooner than later, and it'll be sooner than later. Short center field, and jogging in to make the catch is John Nett. So, Hersman put a barrel to it, but lifted it into short field, short center field, and the catch made by Nett, ending the inning. BYU, no runs on one hit. There was an error, and three were left aboard. 4-0 Kansas. We go top two on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Clear.
For BYU Sports, the excitement is back and bigger than ever. We're taking on the Big 12. Are you geared up and ready to cheer them on? The BYU Store is the number one source for all your quality authentic BYU gear. Get your official Big 12 merch, game day tee, and the latest Nike sideline clothing, just like the BYU players and coaches wear. Shop the campus store, the stadium store, or online at BYUstore.com. For the widest selection of BYU clothing and accessories, the BYU Store, official hub for BYU fans.
Oh, and we never charge change or cancellation fees. That's pretty nice, huh? The Breeze app or flybreeze.com have all the options to book a trip. Breeze Airways.
Great story can change your world. At BYU Radio, we celebrate the power of faith and belief. Download the free BYU Radio app or listen wherever you get your podcasts.
You're listening to BYU Baseball. Here's the voice of the Cougars, Greg Rubel.
Top two here at Miller Park. BYU down 4-0. Ben Hansen to Luke Lido. Beg your pardon, Chase Jans. Lido, the last batter in the first inning. Jans, the first batter in the second. His eight came to the plate for the Jayhawks in the first. So leading off the second, Chase Jans, a left fielder. 0-1 goes to 0-2. Called strike on the inside edge there to Jans, making his eighth start in left field today. On deck is the leadoff hitter in the order, John Nett. Nett struck out to lead off the game for KU. Jans awaits the 1-2. Goes to 2-2, that in the dirt. Ben Hansen making his seventh appearance and seventh start of the year. Into his 32nd inning of work this season. Brings the glove to his chest, kicks and fires. And that'll be low again for ball three. Three balls, two strikes to Chase Jans. Jans is in the due vicinity. He's one for his last 11 over his last six games. He can now make it to 1-for-12. Grounder to short. Make the second base. Handled by Crew Robinson and throw over to Cooper Vest. And one gone. So the 4-3 and Jans is retired. One out for John Nett. Top of the order here for KU in the top of the second. 4-0 Jayhawks. And barrels that right at Luke Anderson. Liner to left and two gone. Cody Shojinaga, who walked and scored the Jayhawks' first run in the first inning, will now bat with two gone and no one on. KU four runs on three hits in the first. 4-0 here, top two. A Jans ground out, a net fly out. A line out, really, to Luke Anderson. That was scorched, but on a low arc right to Anderson in left field. Shojinaga takes ball one. Grounder to short. Coming up with his Beck. It's three up, three down. A quick inning for BYU on defense. We go bottom two for KU. No runs, no hits, no errors, and no one left on. 4-0 Jayhawks, bottom two next here on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
I'm unique, and so are my financial needs. That's why when Zions Bank says they're dedicated to valuing you, supporting you, serving you, understanding you, protecting you. services designed to meet my unique financial needs, no matter what stage of life I find myself in. It's just one of the many ways Zions Bank is for you and for me. A division of Zions Bank Corporation, N.A., member FDIC, equal housing lender, and MLS number 467014.
Cougar Nation, your game day just got upgraded. Download the BYU Cougars mobile app and check out Game Day Mode. Your destination for all things game day. Immerse yourself in the ultimate fan experience, including live highlights, rosters, and game notes. Elevate your in-game experience with interactive games and activations. Find the app now by searching BYU Cougars in the Apple App or Google Play Stores and download today.
Hi, I'm Sam.
They are most of the
rules. And on the next hour of storytelling from BYU Radio, we'll hear stories that will remind you of the Fox News who passed down wisdom to you in your life. Charlotte Blake Alston with a story about how Raccoon got his dinner. We'll hear a story called Muscabe, the Wind Eagle by Joseph Rochette. Join us right here on Google the Apple Podcast.
This is BYU Cougars Baseball on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
BYU Baseball brought to you by Bam Bam's Barbecue. Perfectly smoking each cut of meat just for you. Come on in and enjoy Central Texas Barbecue right here in Provo. Bam Bam's Barbecue, authentic to the bone. We go bottom two here at Miller Park. And the Cougars lead off with Parker Goff. Seven-hole hitter, hitting the lead off the second. Parker coming into the day hitting 241. But he does lead BYU in on-base percentage at 465. Fouls off the first pitch from Dutton and now takes ball one. So 1-1 the count from Dutton to Goff. Goff getting his fifth start at catcher. The 1-1. Thought about it and lays off an 89-mile-per-hour fastball that finds top of the zone for strike two. So Dutton ahead of Goff here, 1-2. Goff catching in place of the injured Colin Reuter, but some good news on the Reuter front. More on that in a moment. And a punch out, caught looking, a backward K, and third strikeout of the day for Reese Dutton as Goff is down on strikes. Colin Reuter left a game last weekend in Lubbock with elbow pain, but the news has come back more or less good on that front, and he could be back playing baseball as soon as tomorrow for BYU. We shall see, but the good news for Colin is nothing long-term, it would appear, on that surgically repaired elbow. But for the meantime, it's Parker Goff behind the plate until Reuter returns, and that may be as soon as tomorrow. We shall see. The 1-0 meantime from Dutton to Painter. Keone Painter hitting out of the 8th spot today. Two balls, no strikes to Painter. Painter, BYU center fielder, takes three straight balls. And getting it done on a 3-0 count with the auto take for Painter is Dutton with a fastball down the heart. Three balls and a strike. 3-1 to Painter. And Dutton lost him on five pitches. So one-out walk to Keone Painter. The first walk issue today by Dutton. He has hit a batter. Ben Hansen has also walked and hit a batter. So nine-hole hitter Chipper Beck will now bat with one on and one gone in the bottom of the second. 4-0 Kansas. KU four runs on three hits. They have the game's lone error. BYU no runs on a single hit. Dutton working third base side of the rubber, facing Beck, the right-handed hitter. Righty v. righty here. First pitch he sees, lifts it to center field. John Nett will jog in, make the catch, and two are gone. Here in the bottom of the second. Back to first goes Keone Painter. Top of the order now, Luke Anderson, who doubled to lead off BYU's game. Of course, he came to bat with the team already trailing 4-0. Did lead things off in the bottom of the first with a double. He was stranded. Cougars left the bases loaded after Herdsman flied out, popped up to center to end inning number one. Here in inning number two, it's Luke Anderson for the second time today. One on, two gone for Luke, who takes breaking ball at strike one. Crew Robinson on deck. lefty bat for Coach Trent Pratt. Luke hitting righty and takes another breaker. Strike two. Oh, ball, no balls, two strikes, two gone, and one on here, bottom two. Luke in his last five coming in two today, hitting 476. That number gets near 500 with that double in the first. Opposite field again. Right fielder on the run into the corner, and Lito will make the catch on the run on the warning track. So Luke, who doubled to the right field corner in the first, hit it in the air to the right field corner here in the second, but Lito well on his horse and made the catch to end the inning. So for BYU, no runs, no hits, no errors, and one was left aboard. We go top three, KU 4, BYU 0 on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Like juicy pears, zesty oranges, and fresh carrots reach our shelves. Because when it comes to fresh, our higher standards mean fresher produce. Smith's, fresh for everyone.
Moving is so stressful. And trying to juggle the kids and job in the middle of it all is enough to drive anyone crazy. But it doesn't have to be that way. The local movers and Shirley's Moving and Storage have the expertise to move the They'll do it fast and they're very experienced. They've been moving people to and from Utah and beyond since 1952. They even moved BYU Athletics, located in
Southern.
I really do believe in the literal power of storytelling.
Let's just sit down and talk about it. Listen to this person's story. Have you thought about this perspective? And I really do think that one-on-one conversations and make connection for people. I do think that they strengthen families and have a big impact then about how we show up in the world.
For more Cougar baseball, let's rejoin Greg Rubel.
Top three here at Miller Park. Kansas 4, BYU no score. Lenny Ashby, left-handed hitter facing the right-handed Ben Hansen to open the third. Ashby flew out to right in the first. It's a four-run first for Kansas. The 1-0. Ashby takes the barrel off the shoulder, holds back. On a fastball at 90 from Hansen. Called strike one and one the count. Ashby the DH. Now two for his last 31 at the plate. Has reached base in five straight, however. A slow grounder to Cooper Vest at first. Will take it himself, step on the bag, and one gone here in the top of the third. So BYU has retired five in a row after the Jayhawks got busy in the first and put four across. Jake English, right-handed hitting catcher. Two-run home run to get things going for KU in the first. Lashes one out of play, opposite field, down the first baseline. Yeah, English, the two-run shot was his seventh. And those seven home runs lead the Jayhawks roster. RBIs 17 and 18 for English. Lays off on the off-speed, one and one the count. English now with hits in eight of his last 10 games. The 1-1, kick and fire from Ben. Up top for ball two. Fastball missing in the high 80s there. The English home run also extends to five games his current hit streak. KU playing in Provo for the first time in 11 years. This weekend, foul to the backstop, 2-2. The last time KU played here, Adam Law was BYU's starting third baseman. Now Adam Law is BYU's third base coach. 2-2. Foul back out of play. Count stays 2-2. Behind us at Gale Miller Field, BYU softball taking on Houston in a matchup of the Cougars, and BYU is a 10-3 lead top four. First of three. They're going to play two tomorrow, so they've already made a change with weather coming in on the weekend. They've already decided to play two tomorrow. We'll see what BYU and KU decide to do based on the forecast later. The 2-2. And that'll be opposite field, and we'll get down about a yard fair down the first base line, and digging for two is Jake English in a stand-up double. So English today 2-for-2 with a two-run home run and a two-bagger. One-out double for English. It'll bring up Ben Hartle. Hartle, the first baseman, was hit by a pitch and scored on a Collier-Cranford double in the first. Cranford then scored on a Michael Brooks single, and that was the fourth of four runs across in the first. 4-0 KU, top three. Jayhawks have four runs on now their fourth hit there from Jake English. BYU no runs on one hit. Check swing take and a fastball, strike one to Hartle. The Cougars got the bullpen active in the first. They calmed the fire. The Cougars did defensively, and no one throwing actively right now in the pen as Hansen looks to settle in. He's got a 1-1 count going to Ben Hartle. Hartle 5 for his last 9 with 4 runs. Foul to the backstop, 1-2 to Hartle. Ben Hartle's taken his average from 200 to 310 in the space of a week. As he gets his reps up, the 1-2. And fouled out of play down the first baseline. Count remains 1-2, 1 out, 1 on. Runner in scoring position for Hartle is Jake English at second with a 1-out double. With runners in scoring position, Hartle hitting 500 on the year. In limited looks, the 1-2. Wind blowing in from center. And that'll be opposite field, right field corner. Anderson gives chase, will not get there. Herdsman gave chase, beg your pardon, as it drops into the right field corner. Coming around third, and just ahead of the tag is English. And it's an RBI double for Hartle. So back-to-back doubles for the Jayhawks. I think it picks it up. As Herdsman gave chase in the right field corner, it got down on the track and drives in the Jayhawks' fifth run of the day. So KU 5 and BYU no score. Top three here in Provo. 5 runs on 5 hits now, and back-to-back doubles for Kansas. English, who then scores on the Hartle double. English's double was his 6th, and Hartle's his 3rd of the year. 5-0 KU. Van Hansen delivers fastball high for ball one. High in the air. Foul territory down the first baseline. It will drop beyond the temporary bleacher stands and well out of play. 1-1 the count. To Collier Cranford. Cranford is the batter. RBI double for Collier in the first. He had a hit for the cycle last Friday against UCF. A hit for the cycle in order. Single, double, triple, home run in succession. Becoming the 3rd Jayhawk in the last 30 years to hit for the cycle. Takes an off-speed called strike for strike two. Cranford's RBI in the first was his 21st. As he leads KU in that category. Grounder to Crew Robinson at second. Fires over to first and Vest on the 4-3 ground out. Retires Cranford. So Michael Brooks will now bat with 2 gone and 1 on. As advancing to third on the play is Hartle on the 4-3. So Hartle on third for Michael Brooks. He singled home the 4th Kansas run of the first inning. We're now 5-0 KU, top three here in Provo. Michael Brooks' hit streak goes to 4 games with that RBI single in the first. Change up in for a strike from Hansen. 0-1 to Brooks. Foul back, strike two. So Ben gets ahead of Michael Brooks, 0-2. Brooks has started all 23 games at the hot corner for Kansas. Brooks has played previously at Arkansas and UCF. He's out of Florida, Wellington, Florida. 0-2 to Brooks. Gets a bat on the off speed and fouls it out of play on the ground down the third baseline. Remains an 0-2 count. BYU has lost three in a row coming into today. KU's lost 4 of 6, 6 of 9 coming into the day. Both teams 4 and 5 in Big 12 play. Again, KU's got that string of series opening wins going. A check swing, third strike not caught, or did catch it. He did. That'll be a strikeout for Ben Hansen. So BYU gets out of the inning, but another run scores. A run on two hits. There were no errors, and one was left on. We go bottom three, 5-0 Kansas on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Is LASIK right for you? At Utah Eye Centers, we've answered that question for over 25 years. With 4 locations and advanced technology, Utah Eye Centers has more experience and more answers. At Utah Eye Centers, we've seen it all.
Now that BYU is in the Big 12 Conference, it's no surprise. The Cougars are facing some tough competition. As a business owner, you experience the same thing every day with your company. So let's work together. You'll be a vital part of our team by supporting BYU's 623 student-athletes, and we'll assist your organization in getting the results you want. Email sponsorship at BYU.edu.
That's sponsorship at BYU.edu today.
BYU Athletics and your business. Let's team up.
Eliminate the need for contacts and glasses and start seeing more clearly in a few days. Call Utah Eye Centers, where more people have trusted for their LASIK surgery than any other Utah provider. At Utah Eye Centers, we've seen it all.
Hey, it's Julie. This week on Top of Mind, American teens are struggling.
When you are sleep deprived, unfortunately, it does increase the risk of suicidality.
If you take away social media for some kids, their depression's going to get worse.
But there is a bit of good news.
Kids are asking for support in a way that I think they weren't doing before because we just weren't even talking about it.
Addressing the teen mental health crisis is this week on Top of Mind. You can listen on Spotify or anywhere you get podcasts.
You're listening to BYU Baseball. Here's the voice of the Cougars, Greg Wrubell.
Crew Robinson leads off the BYU third, facing Reese Dutton. And there's a 3-4 hole single to right for Crew Robinson. Lead runner aboard for BYU for the second time in 3 innings. Crew with his first hit of the day. He reached on an E6 in the first, was stranded. Now leads off the third with a single to right. Easton Jones will now bat. Easton's reached base in his last 4 games, struck out swinging in the first. Struck out with 2 aboard, then Kuhio Aloy struck out with 2 aboard. Once Vest got aboard to lead the bases, Herdsman flied out to center to end the bases-loaded threat as BYU was down 4-0 early, had a chance to get back into it early, but Herdsman left him loaded. Nothing happened in the second for BYU, and here we are in the third with Robinson a leadoff single to right. Ball one taken by Jones. Opposite field in the air to right. Luke Leto jogging over to his left makes the grab, and Easton Jones is now 0-2. Luke Leto on the grab at right, and one gone. One on for Kuhio Aloy. Kuhio Aloy, 0-1 with a strikeout. Does have 9 RBI in his last 6 games coming in 2 today. Big part of it, that grand slam last weekend in Lubbock. Robinson takes his lead off first as Kuhio Aloy takes off speed away for ball one. In Big 12 play, first in the league in wins and innings pitched, Reese Dutton. The 1-0 in tight for ball two, 2-0, fastball at 88. Missing inside. BYU's long losing streak on the year, 3 games. And that's a streak they're on right now. It's happened twice, 2 3-game skids for BYU. They're in one now, looking to avoid a season-long 4-game rut. That's called strike. Breaker finds the lower outside part of the frame to make it a 2-1 count. Kansas's 10 wins have come in 5 pairs of 2 losses. And they're on a 2-game set coming into a 2-game losing set coming into today, and another called strike in the low 80s, evens count at 2-2. KU won the opener against UCF last weekend, lost the last two in that series. Did all their scoring in the first game of three, the 2-2, and a swinging strikeout for Kuhio Aloy, down on strikes for the second time today, and both strikeouts swinging. And for Reese Dutton, that is strikeout number four on the day. Three have been of the forward variety. It'll bring up the left-handed hitting Cooper Vest with one on and two gone here in the bottom of the third. BYU trailing 5-0. Kansas five runs on five hits. BYU hitless on, or scoreless on two hits. A double in the first, a single here in the third. That's it for BYU so far. Vest hit by a pitch and was stranded in the first. Fouls off home plate. Strike one, the count two. Cooper Vest 0-1. BYU 11-11 on the year. 7-7 in the daytime and 4-4 at night. KU 8-9 in the matinees, a 4-1 record at night. No balls and a strike to BYU's first baseman Vest, and swings through 82 for 0-2. Dutton ahead. Reese Dutton looking to win his sixth consecutive start. 5-1 on the year. Coming into Provo. No balls, two strikes. Dutton works third base side of the rubber. Comes set, winds and fires. And a swinging strikeout number five on the day. Strikeout number five, four swinging and one looking. Vest out on strikes. And BYU puts one aboard and leaves him there. Leadoff single goes nowhere for BYU. No runs on a hit, no errors, and one left on. We go top four, KU five, BYU no score. On the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
As the world leader in essential oils, doTERRA's products help athletes around the world maintain the highest level of health and wellness. Our products are responsibly sourced and maximize performance, rest, and recovery for athletes at any level. doTERRA is proud to be the title sponsor of BYU Baseball and to support the student athletes with their health and wellness goals. Learn more about how you can up your health and wellness game at doTERRA.com. doTERRA, pursue what's pure.
You're unique, and so are your financial needs. That's why, at Zions Bank, we're dedicated to supporting you, saving you, equipping you, educating you, inspiring you, cheering you, and providing you with tools and services designed to meet you where you are, no matter where you find yourself. It's just one of the many ways Zions Bank is for you. A division of Zions Bank Corporation, NA member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender, NMLS number 467014.
Life can be a lot of things. A little bit of this, some of that, a lot of this. And maybe even, not even sure what that is. What we all need is more.
Top four here in Provo. We're a third of the way home. 5-0 Kansas. Leading off the Jayhawks fourth is Luke Leto. Leto struck out swinging in the first. Leto, left-handed batter, facing the right-handed Ben Hansen, the 0-1. And that's a line drive on the ground. Fair down the first baseline into the right field corner. And stopping at second with Kansas's fourth double of the day already is Luke Leto. So Leto's now reached base in seven consecutive games. And leadoff double for the Jayhawks, bringing up Chase Jans out of the nine hole. So the sixth hit of the day for KU. The ball game right now comes down to this stat. BYU is 0-9 batting with runners on, and KU is 4-8 batting with runners on. And there's a runner on for the Jayhawks to lead off the fourth. Fouled at the screen by Jans. 0-1 the count. Pitchers in the BYU bullpen are not yet back up and active. They were active early in the first inning, but gave Ben Hansen time to settle in. Comes in tight to even the count at 1-1 on Jans. So doubles today for Cranford, English, Hartle, and now Leto. Five extra base hits when you throw in the Jake English two-run home run. Slow grounder to third. Charging hard is Easton Jones. Fires over to Vest at first. And on the 5-3, one gone. Staying at second is Leto. Now, so six hits for Kansas and five of them for extra bases. One gone, one on. Top four, 5-0 Kansas. To take me out to the ball game, you hear, is over at the softball game behind us. As it's 10-3 for the Cougars over the Cougars, BYU leading Houston, top five at Gale Miller Field. No balls and a strike meantime to John Nett. Nett, top of the order, third batter in the inning. Reaches out to ground one to second. Crew Robinson will handle. Fire over to Vest at first, and on the 4-3, ground out to Argonne. And moving to third on the play is Lido. So runner at third for Cody Shojinaga. As Nett is retired, 4-3. Shojinaga walked and scored in the first, grounded out to short in the second. He bats now in the fourth. His team's up 5-0. Wind picking up, blowing from right field to left out of the southwest here at Miller Park. In tight for ball one. Let's take a look at the pitching numbers brought to you by Big O Tires. It's On the Rubber, presented by Big O Tires, the team you trust. Kansas that's driven into center field. We'll hang for this for a second. The fly out to Painter retires the side. We'll get those pitching numbers for you in the bottom of the fourth. We'll take a break. We're through 3.5 for Kansas. No runs on a hit, no errors. One left on. 5-0 Jayhawks. Bottom four next here on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Plus, for a limited time, Mountain America will donate $100 to the student-athlete mentoring program for every new BYU credit card opened.
Help support BYU athletics.
Get your BYU credit card from Mountain America today.
Loans on approved credit. Membership required based on eligibility. Limited time offer also available with BYU debit cards. Offer can change or be withdrawn at any time. Offer ends 12/31/2024.
This is BYU Radio on 107.9 FM KUMT Randolph. You're listening to Cougar Baseball on BYU Radio.
Cougar fans, it's time to gear up and get ready for BYU sports. The excitement is back and bigger than ever. We're taking on the Big 12. Are you geared up and ready to cheer them on? The BYU Store is the number one source for all your quality, authentic BYU gear. Get your official Big 12 merch, game day tee, and the latest Nike sideline clothing, just like the BYU players and coaches wear. Shop the campus store, the stadium store, or online at BYUstore.com for the widest selection of BYU clothing and accessories. The BYU Store, official outfitter of BYU fans everywhere.
What's up, everyone? I'm Lauren McClain for Cougar Tailgate. Joining me on this week's episode is Hema Hamouli and former BYU basketball star Jonathan Tavernari. We discuss what it takes to have a good run in March and if BYU's lack of Sunday play is actually beneficial for the Cougars. Plus, we hear from you, the fans, about how far BYU would have to go in the NCAA tournament for you to consider it a successful season. You can join the Cougar Tailgate wherever you get your podcasts and on the BYU Radio app.
For more Cougar baseball, let's rejoin Greg Rubel.
We go bottom four here at Miller Park, and Bryker Herdsman leads off the long foul out of play down the first baseline. Strike one. As the count is opened by Reese Dutton. Back to those Big O Tires On the Rubber pitching numbers as Dutton delivers to Herdsman. Herdsman drives that high and deep to center field. Center fielder Nett back into the track and watches it go over the wall. The Cougars open their scoring in the bottom of the fourth with a solo home run from Bryker Herdsman. Herdsman makes it 5-1 with a shot to center field. Our first Zions Bank home run of the day. And it comes courtesy of Bryker Herdsman for banking that helps you game plan for life. Zions Bank is for you. Zions Bank home run makes it 5-1. The Cougars cut into the Kansas lead. Herdsman with his fourth home run of the year and seventh of his collegiate career. So four-run ball game now. Parker Goff will step in to face Dutton. And he drives that to center field. But right at the center fielder Nett makes the catch, one out. So back to those pitching numbers before that batter. Dutton had gone three complete, now three and a third, has given up three hits, one run earned, has struck out five, walked one, hit one batter, gave up that home run to Herdsman seconds ago. BYU pitching through four innings. Ben Hansen's given up six hits, five runs all earned, three strikeouts and a walk. One hit batsman That's Big O Tires on the Rubber pitching report brought to you by Big O Tires, the team you trust. All right, we're back into it here. Bottom four, 5-1 ball game, and Keone Painter is the batter. Breiker Herdsman home run to center. Parker Goff fly out to center. And Keone fouls away to get himself into an 0-2 hole. Keone was stranded after walking in the second. For BYU, home run number 28 on the year. And exactly 2-1. Home run ratio over the opponents at 28-14. Ball one meantime to Painter. One ball, two strikes, ball low from Dutton. Dutton full windup and delivery. And down and in, taken for ball two. 2-2 the count to Keone Painter, BYU center fielder. Hits in four of his last five games coming in two today. Hitless on the day. A walk in the second. The 2-2. That skips under the glove of the catcher English all the way to the backstop. Count is full. Three balls, two strikes. Chipper Beck is on deck. 5-1. Kansas leading it. Cougars' first run coming on the Herdsman solo shot moments ago. We fouled out a play down the left field line into the BYU dugout. Where pitchers and catchers are milling about but not doing anything in the way of warming up at the moment. A 3-2 with one gone and no one on to Painter. And a swing and a miss from Keone. Swing through 86. That's already strikeout number six for Reese Dutton here in the fourth inning. Two strikeouts in the first, both swinging. A strikeout looking in the second. Two swinging strikeouts in the third. And a strikeout swinging here now in the fourth. So of the six strikeouts, five have been swinging. Beck, two gone, no one on. 5-1 Jayhawks. Breaking ball inside, missing for ball one. Chipper getting his 14th start at short. Flied out to center field in the second. And takes a fastball away for ball two. Two balls, no strikes to BYU's nine-hole hitter, Chipper Beck. Luke Anderson is on deck. One for two for Luke today. The 2-0. That's chopped foul off home plate. Two balls and a strike. We're scheduled to go 6 o'clock tomorrow and 1 o'clock on Saturday. Softball's already made the call to wipe off the game Saturday and play a doubleheader tomorrow with the weather forecast on the weekend. That'll be a shot up the middle. Diving stop made by Shojinaga. Comes up firing and what a play. A 4-3 ground out as handled well on a dive to his right. Shojinaga comes up and gets BYU into a 4-3 to end the fourth. For BYU in the fourth inning. One run on one hit. It was a Breiker Herdsman home run solo shot. One run on the hit, no errors, no one left on. We go top five, 5-1 Kansas leading BYU on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Exercise plans? Actually, you don't have to look far. Just look to the first two letters of the word wellness. We means you don't have to figure it out yourself. It means your hopes and challenges are a perfect match for our knowledge and resources. It means anything you want to achieve, together, we can achieve better. Because wellness begins with we. Intermountain Health, the power of we.
Telling stories is like looking at the stars. Meet Sam Payne, host of The Appleseed.
When we engage with the stories of the world, we turn our hearts and we turn our thoughts to the people who have told and kept those stories. When we share old stories, we think about the generations who kept and told those stories. And when we tell new stories, we leave a breadcrumb trail for people to discover us when we're gone in the telling and sharing and hearing of their stories.
The Appleseed, available wherever you get your podcasts.
You're listening to BYU Baseball. Here's the voice of the Cougars, Greg Wrubell.
Top of the fifth here at Miller Park in Provo, Utah. Kansas 5 and BYU 1. Lenny Ashby leads off and takes ball 1 to start the half inning. And takes ball 2 to make a 2-0 count. Lenny Ashby 0 for 2 today. Fly out to right in the first and a ground out to Cooper Vest at first in the third, 0 for 2. Two balls, no strikes. Ben Hansen to Lenny Ashby, left-handed hitter and righty on the hill. And Ben pipes in an 89-mile-per-hour fastball, lower part of the frame, but a called strike. Two balls and a strike. Precipitation now picking up on this cool, blustery day here in Provo. A check swing appealed at third and no go. So three balls and a strike to Ashby. Yeah, the weather is at the moment inclement, let's call it. 3-1. And the breaking ball stays high, curve missing up top, and a five-pitch walk of Ashby. So he's now reached base in a sixth consecutive game. And lead batter aboard for the Jayhawks. So standing and talking and looking and watching, but no throwing yet in the BYU bullpen. As people are bundling up and covering up here at Miller Park. That's a grooved in fastball, lower part of the frame, 88-mile-per-hour called strike. Strike one to Jake English. English having himself a day, 2 for 2 with 2 runs scored and 2 RBI. Takes low and away, count 1-1. Jake English came to bat with Cody Shojinaga aboard in the first and brought him home with a 2-run home run to left field, then doubled and scored in the third. English now batting .338, slugging .718, and fouls out of play down the first base line. Yeah, the cold rain picking up in intensity here at Larry H. Miller Field. The worst weather was to come later in the day, but it's already underway. This game is into its fifth inning, 5-1, Kansas leading at top five. The 1-2, no one out, one on. For English, he's gone Ashby on first. That'll be in the dirt, and the dirt is figurative here at Miller Park, the all-artificial surface, the dirt-colored area around home plate. 2 balls, 2 strikes to English. Kansas slugging percentage, on-base percentage, and runs leader, and helping all those categories today. The 2-2. A reach-out grounder back to Hansen. Double clutches to get it out of his glove. To second for one, over to first, and that double clutch kept BYU out of the double play. So Hansen got Beck at second with the relay over to first, not in time to get English. And again, he just didn't get it out of the glove cleanly. Made it on a turn and appeared to have enough time to get two, but it ends up being one on the 1-6. So Ashby out at second on the 1-6, and reaching on the fielder's choice is English. One ball, no strike to Hartle. Ben Hartle, the first baseman, next batter, and fifth in the order for the Jayhawks. 1-0 to Hartle. Fastball high, ball 2. 2 balls, no strikes. So Lenny Ashby, a leadoff walk, was erased as BYU tried to turn two. They were not able to get English at first, and he is on first for Hartle. 2 balls, no strikes from Hansen to Hartle. And brushed him. So he'll take his base. Now first and second with one out for Collier Cranford. The precipitation lightening up just perceptibly. As the wind is now blowing in from center, so a more southerly wind now blowing. Most players out here today in some sort of long sleeve, but all short sleeves is Collier Cranford. And swings and misses at the off speed from Hansen Lowe. Strike one. Hansen winds and deals, and slider misses away for ball one. 1 ball, 1 strike, 1 out, 2 on English on second, Hartle on first after an HBP of Hartle. Second hit batsman by Hansen today. Foul back to the screen, 1-2. Ben Hansen today has walked 2 and hit 2. 5-1 Jayhawks. We're top 5, 1 gone, 2 aboard for Collier Cranford in a 1-2 count. Cranford is 0-1 for 2 on the day. And is now 1-for-3 on a swinging strikeout. That'll be the second out and bring up Michael Brooks. So Ben Hansen with 4 strikeouts on the day, all of the swinging variety. The two pitchers combining for 10 Ks so far through 4 2/3. Michael Brooks, RBI single in the first, strikeout swinging to end the third. 1-for-2 today is Brooks, hitting .296. He's got a runner in scoring position, hitting .444 with runners in scoring position. Takes the barrel off the shoulder and takes an off-speed called strike one by home plate umpire Christopher Griffith. 0-1 to Brooks. And barrels that off one hop into left. Coming around third is English. The throw coming home. It's in time, but not found by Parker Goff. Lost it in the glove and the protective padding and never got to swipe a tag down. And so scoring on the play is English on the sharp single to left. The throw was in time, but it just wasn't gathered cleanly by Goff. And so it's 6-1 Kansas now. 6 runs on 7 hits for KU, still first and second. As English scores from second, Hartle goes to second, and Michael Brooks with a single to left drives home his second run of the day. He's 2-for-3 with 2 RBI. And 7-1, a 6-1 Kansas here in the top of the fifth. 2 aboard for Luke Lido. Left-handed hitting Lido. Ball high and away, 1-0 the count. Four in the first, 1 in the third, 1 in the fifth so far for Kansas. Fastball inside, down and too far in, 2 balls, no strikes. So Michael Brooks, 2 of the 6 runs, 2 of the 6 runs batted in for KU. Lido struck out swinging in the first, doubled him and stranded in the fourth. He's now 1-for-2 today, and in a 2-0 count, takes a called strike, fastball. Down the heart, maybe toward the outside edge for the left-handed hitting Lido. 2 balls and a strike. 2 out, 2 on. The 2 on. Hartle on second. And Brooks on first. Hartle reaching on an HBP. And Brooks with the RBI single. The 2-1 from Hansen. Swinging, missing everything was Lido for 2-2. That hard-cutting slider from Hansen evens account. Two up for BYU. Heart of the order. Grounder up the middle. Shortstop Beck will handle. Step on second for the final out of the inning. So for Kansas in the fifth, another run on a hit. There were no errors, and 2 were left aboard. 6-1 Kansas. We go bottom 5. We're halfway home here on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
When was the last time you had your teeth cleaned? Heart disease, Alzheimer's, stroke, dementia, and other inflammatory health conditions have been linked to periodontitis, a severe stage of gum disease. To help fight against gum disease and inflammatory health conditions, have your teeth cleaned regularly by a dentist or hygienist. To review the science behind these findings, go to visityourdentist.org. This message is brought to you by the eAssist Dental Health Education Foundation, reminding you that dental cleanings are essential for your health.
Hi, BYU fans. We're Breeze Airways, the official hometown airline of BYU Athletics. Your newest and nicest airline, now offering flights from Provo Airport to San Francisco, San Bernardino, Orange County, Phoenix, or Hartford, in partnership with the San Bernardino International Airport. Breeze can save you some serious time and money, so you can go, see, and do more than ever before. Oh, and we never charge change or cancellation fees. That's pretty nice, huh? The Breeze app or flybreeze.com have all the options to book a trip. Breeze Airways, seriously nice.
Hello, radio friends. Spencer Linton and Jared Jordan. If you miss any of BYU Sports Station during the week, you always have options to catch up, like downloading our daily podcast or tuning in every Saturday for the best of BYU Sports Station.
session featuring the prominent topic stats and must-hear interviews. Like ESPN college basketball analyst Jay Billis and Sean Paul. Elite, the best BYU sports nation. Saturdays at noon Eastern, only on BYU Radio. I thought that was good.
This is BYU Cougars Baseball on the News Kid, BYU Sports Network.
Welcome back inside Larry H. Miller Field here in Provo, Utah. We've hit the halfway point. 4.5 in the books. 6-1 Jayhawks, bottom five, and Luke Anderson leads off. Top of the order, due up for BYU. Called strike to Luke. Breaker from Reese Dutton. Luke today 1-for-2, double and stranded in the first, and flied out to right in the second. Bats now in the fifth, and takes inside to even the count at 1-1. A sharp single to center for Luke Anderson. Leadoff single for BYU. And the Cougs have the lead runner aboard for the third time in five innings, but both previous times that batter's been stranded. See if the Cougs can improve their fortune with runners aboard here. Again, BYU 0-for-9 today with runners on, and Kansas 5-for-15 with base runners aboard. 6-1 KU, bottom five. Left-handed hitting Crew Robinson with Luke Anderson on first, and Crew goes opposite field. Left fielder Jan's back end near the track, about 2 yards shy, makes the catch on the run, and retreating to first is Anderson. Robinson flies out to left. One gone for Easton Jones. Six-one Kansas, bottom five here at Miller Park. Six runs on seven hits for KU, one run on four hits for BYU. Easton Jones 0-for-2 today, striking out in the first and flying out to right in the third. Anderson on first for Jones. Jones fouls to the screen, 0-1. Easton hitting .329, slugging at a .598 clip. He's batting .300 with runners on. He's got a runner on in Luke Anderson at first. Leadoff single for Luke. Luke's 2-for-3 today. BYU's batting average and hits leader. Buttressing his stats in those categories as Easton Jones falls into an 0-2 hole. Reese Dutton, the 6'2", 210-pound senior right-hander on the hill, working third base side of the rubber. Ahead on Jones, 0-2. Breaking ball popped up. Foul down the first base line. Out of play. It'll stay 0-2 with one gone and one on. BYU with Kansas for three this weekend. No midweek game for BYU next week. And then at Texas for three next weekend, Thursday, Friday, Saturday in Austin. Activity now in the BYU bullpen. I'll tell you who's up in a moment. 0-2. To Easton Jones. Check back at first. First throw we've seen back to the first base bag today, I believe. Either pitcher. Jake Porter is warming. Right-hander up in the BYU pen. Ben Hansen's gone. Five complete. Trails by five to the Cougars, 6-1. And a swinging strikeout on the breaker away. Easton Jones down on strikes for the second time swinging today. So a leadoff single, then a fly out and a strikeout. And the Cougars again still looking for their first hit with a runner aboard. And that's the number right now. BYU 0-for-11 with runners on right now. They've had base path traffic, but not a lot of advancement. The Cougars' lone run coming on a solo home run from Bryker Herdsman to lead off the fourth. Grounder right back at the pitcher, Kuhio Aloy. Sharply back to the mound, and that'll do it. So BYU's leadoff single stays at first. Kuhio Aloy on the 1-3 ground out. And for BYU, no runs on one hit, no errors, and one left to board. We go to the top of the sixth, Kansas 6 and BYU 1 on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
BYU Athletics, and have a conversation about our partnership. It can make 114 cars every hour. Two cars every minute.
Really? What's the first car they ever made?
Got Jake in now. Porter.
Wow. Were their bicycles as fast as their cars?
No.
Learn more about the Telluride Forte or new 7-passenger EV9 at Doug Smith Kia in American Fork or DougSmithKia.com. Because no one knows Kia like Doug.
Are you a BYU radio fan? If so, and you find yourself tuning in on regular, then why not leave us a review? You wouldn't lose a thing if you took a minute to rate us or your favorite show on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, and you'd be helping us improve how we deliver the good to your life. So, whether you like what we're doing or think we can improve, let us know. Listen wherever you get your podcasts or download the BYU Radio app. And thank you for making BYU Radio a part of your day.
For more Cougar Baseball, let's rejoin Greg Grubel.
Welcome back to Larry H. Miller Field, Miller Park, Provo, Utah. BYU in Kansas. We go top six, Kansas six, and BYU one is our score. Time for a PZ Printing pitching change brought to you by PZ Printing. Nothing inspires like print. New pitcher for BYU is Jake Porter. Right-hander hits the hill for his ninth appearance of the season. He'll face the nine-hole hitter, Chase Jans, and deliver a ball well away for ball one. Porter, in eight appearances, a 0.82 ERA, 1-0 record, 11 innings pitched, has given up nine hits, one run. It was earned, swing and a miss, evens count 1-1, a 10-3 strikeout to walk ratio for Porter. Jake, 5'11", 200-pound junior out of South Weber, Utah, Northridge High School product, 1-1. To Jans goes to 2-1. 6-1 is our score. BYU's fortunes to this point about as bright as the weather. Cold and gray and now rainy. 2-1 to Jans. 6-1, the KU lead. And four pitches delivered, three balls, 3-1 now. That fastball low and away. Chase Jans, 0-2 today. Pair of groundouts, 4-3 and 5-3. Fouls it to the screen, count goes full at 3-2. Jake Porter, four-pitch mix. Fastball, slider, curve, and change. Fastball tops out around 92. That last pitch, 91, fouled away, 3-2. And that'll be a grounder to short. Back handles on a couple of hops, comes up gunning and over to Vest. And Jans is retired now on three groundouts, a 4-3, a 5-3, and now a 6-3. So Jans sprinting it around the infield so far. One gone for the top of the order. John Nett. Nett is 0-3. Strikeout, a flyout, and a groundout. In his last game, he ended a 10-game hit streak as he went 0-3 in the series finale against UCF. Right-handed Nett facing the righty Porter. 1-0 the count goes to 2-0, so Jake delivers a couple balls early into Nett. Again, fastball low 90s for Jake, slider in the high 70s, curve in the mid-70s, and a change in the low 80s. Your four-pitch mix for Jake. The 2-0. Three straight balls delivered to Nett. So John Nett, with walks in four of his last five games, may make it 5-6, unless Porter can find the zone. And Porter finds his zone. Fastball at 90 through the heart, 3-1 the count. Game one of three, BYU and KU. Sharp grounder backhanded by Jones at third. Over to Vest at first, and two are gone. So a 6-3 and a 5-3 on the groundouts for KU here in the top of the sixth. Cody Shojinaga will now bat. Shojinaga walked and scored in the first, scored the first run of the game, then grounded out 6-3 in the second, and flied out to center to end the fourth. BYU's had the lead runner aboard in four of five innings, but have not done much with the base path traffic. The only lead batter to score was actually the one who scored himself. Bryker Herdsman led off the fourth with a solo home run. Ball one to Shojinaga. Ball two to Shojinaga, and Porter's getting behind every hitter he's facing here. And that'll be driven on the ground in the left field corner. Extra bases for Shoji Naga. The Big 12's doubles leader adds another two-bagger to his tally and gets his first hit of the day. Now 1-for-3 on the day. Shoji Naga at second with a double to the left field corner. A two-out double for KU. Hit number 8 on the day. And of Kansas's 8 hits, 6 are for extra bases. That's the 5th double to go along with a home run and a pair of singles. So KU upping its doubles tally on the year to 59. 1-0 meantime to Lenny Ashby. Left-handed hitting Ashby gets ahead of that one and grounds it foul to the KU dugout area, 1-1. So Shoji Naga with a two-out double is at second in scoring position for Lenny Ashby. Ashby batting 227 with runners in scoring position, a little lower than his season average of 250. Ashby is 0-for-2 today with a walk. That'll be in tight, 2-1. Again, Porter having a tough time working ahead. Porter in relief of Ben Hansen. Ben's on the hook. 6-1 Jayhawks here, top 6. Nice pitch from Jake there, off speed. Outside part of the frame for strike 2. 2-2 with 2 out and a board is Shoji Naga at second. Lenny Ashby is due. 2 for his last 32 at the plate. That'll be in the dirt. Blocking well is Goff. Keeps Shoji Naga at second. Ashby with that walk in the 5th, though, did extend his reach base streak to 6 games. The DH today, Ashby, jersey number 52. The full count. 2 gone, 1 on. BYU down 5. And that grounder finds a 5-6 hole into left. Coming around third is Shoji Naga. Anderson comes up firing the play at the plate. Got him! The assist from Luke Anderson. Goff makes the tag. And the call was out. Dropped it. The ball came out. And the run scores. The call was out, but then the ball popped out. And 7-1 Jayhawks. Luke Anderson would have had his second assist on the year. But after applying the tag, the ball popped out. And it's 7-1 Jayhawks. Tough luck for BYU as Shoji Naga scores on the Ashby. Single to left. He advances to second on the throw home. So it's an RBI single for Lenny Ashby, who I said was due. Yeah, 2 for his last 32. You can make it 3 for his last 33 now. The RBI single and 7-1 Jayhawks. Batting is English and the count 0-1. The count now 0-2. Fastball taken inside. No balls, 2 strikes, 2 out, man on second. So Ashby on second on the throw, coming around from second to score after the double. The 2-out double was Shoji Naga. So 2-out action for KU here. And that will be another 5-6 hole single to left. And again coming around, Ashby, the throw offline. The throw to second to get the advancer. No, that's safe, not in time. An 8-1 Jayhawks. Scoring is Ashby from second. And Jake English with an RBI. So back-to-back RBI singles, and Kansas makes it 8-1 here in the top of the 6th. Ben Hardewell now hit. And so with 2 out, Shoji Naga doubles, Ashby and English both single, and single home runs to make it 8-1 KU. Foul to the screen. No one yet up in the BYU pen. Jake Porter trying to get BYU out of the 6th. No balls and a strike on the foul back. A healthy hack for Hartle on the inside pitch. Fastball in tight, and it got him offering and swinging through. Strike 2. 0-2 with 2 out and a man on second. Man on second is English. Ball 1 low. Fastball missing for Jake. 1 ball, 2 strikes, 2 gone, 1 on. The 1 on is English at second. Hartle digging in against Porter. 8-1 Jayhawks. 8 runs, 10 hits for KU. BYU 1 run on 4 hits. Grounder to Beck. Beck over to Vest on a low ball that's picked well by Coop. And that'll do it for Kansas on the 6-3 ground out. But for Kansas, with two out, it's three consecutive hits, two runs on three hits, no errors, and one left on. We go bottom six, 8-1 Jayhawks on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Running a service company can be complicated and time-consuming. That's why we created Skedda, the software that provides everything you need to keep your team efficient and organized. Our full desktop software and mobile app will help you track your vehicles, work orders, hours, billing, and text message communication. As a grounds calls with BYU Athletics, Skedda is happy to adapt the team cards for a voted user of the Skedda software. Visit Skedda.com today to see how we can elevate the company's operations. Skedda, that's SKDIT.com.
Listening to BYU Baseball. Here's the voice of the Cougars, Greg Rubel.
BYU Athletics would like to recognize doTERRA for being today's game sponsor and thank them for being an important part of our team. doTERRA, pursue what's pure. BYU pursuing Kansas out in front of the Cougars. 8-1 are the Jayhawks. We're bottom six, and Cooper Vest lead things off for BYU. Coop swings through strike one. Reese Dutton, fastball past him. To open the count 0-1, Dutton into his sixth inning of work. His long outing is seven. Came in his last outing. 0-1 to Vest. Barrels that to right, but right at the right fielder, Luke Lito, one gone. So today's Major League Baseball opening day. Manager of the Phillies is Rob Thompson, a former Jayhawk. One of his pitchers there in Philly is Michael Rucker, former Cougar. The last time BYU and KU met in Lawrence back in 2016, Rucker was a starting pitcher in that series for BYU. Bryker Herdsman, accounting for BYU's lone run, tries to bunt his way on. And just out at first, handled by the pitcher Dutton. And Dutton comes up firing, gets Herdsman out on a close play at first. Herdsman, I was just saying, accounts for BYU's only run. Solo home run to lead off the fourth, tried to bunt himself on here in the sixth. That ball was placed between third and the pitcher's mound, and Dutton was off the mound quickly and gunning, as a pitcher might, over to first for the out. So Vest flies out to right. Herdsman is retired 1-3 on the bunt attempt, and Parker Goff hitting with two quick outs here in the bottom of the sixth. Breaking ball called strike one. And Dutton favors the breaker over the fastball. It's really his out pitch. A hard-cutting slider, and there's a strike pass Goff for strike two. 0-2 the count with two out, no one on here in the top, bottom of the sixth. KU's not trailed in this game. Took a 5-0 lead before BYU scored its first and only run on the Herdsman solo shot since adding three more to make it 8-1. Four in the first, one in the third, one in the fifth, two in the sixth, and a chase pitch on the 0-2, 1-2 to Parker Goff, BYU's catcher. We'll see if Colin Reuter is back behind the plate tomorrow. Could be as soon as tomorrow that Reuter returns to the lineup after being out for a week or so. A couple straight balls low and away from Goff. 2-2 the count with two out and bases clear here in the sixth. Two-two from Dutton. And three straight balls low and away. So an 0-2 opening to Parker Goff, and since then, three consecutive balls thrown. We're almost two-thirds of the way done here at Miller Park. Today's game is an hour and 34 minutes old. the 3-2. And fouled high and out of play down the first base line. Count stays full. It's only the second to true away series of the year for Kansas. They had a series at Cincinnati, accounting for their only true away games of the year. 1-2 in away games. 7-4 back at Hoagland Ballpark. That's fouled on the ground down the third baseline. 3-2 we stay. Head coach Dan Fitzgerald in his second year, 37-42 his record coming into today. Previously assisting it to LSU and then Dallas Baptist before that. This KU team making strides in the Big 12. The 3-2, a swing and a strike, and strike three. Parker Goff is down on strikes for the second time today. Struck out looking in the second and swinging now in the sixth. And for Reese Dutton, that is strikeout number 8 on the day. He and the Jayhawks having a day. 8-1 KU. We go top 7 next here on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Something that I've come to believe is really important. God has created so many people. The clues of who God is show up in the people he has created. And as I challenge you, I know about God is by collecting the clues to the puzzle that he has dispersed across the world.
Open your mind and heart with In Good Faith wherever you get your podcasts.
This is BYU Cougars Baseball on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Just into the top of the seventh and into an 0-1 count to Collier Cranford, Kansas shortstop, hitting sixth in the order, first in the inning. His team's out to an 8-1 lead, an 0-2 count to Cranford, who on the day is 1-for-3. RBI double in the first, a 4-3 ground out in the third, a strikeout swinging in the fifth. Jake Porter's got him in an 0-2 hole here in the seventh. Stays alive, reaches out, and fouls it off home plate. No balls, two strikes. Big O Tires presents On the Rubber. A look at both teams' pitching numbers brought to you by Big O Tires, the team you trust. We'll take a look at the pitching numbers after this pitch in an 0-2 count from Jake Porter to Collier Cranford. 8-1 Jayhawks, top seven. That's in tight. An appeal and no. One ball, two strikes. Reese Dutton through six has given up 4 hits, 1 run. It was earned. Solo home run. 8 strikeouts to only 1 walk. Hit 1 batter. 79 pitches thrown by Reese Dutton. And a punch out as on the outside edge. Fastball at 88. Catches Cranford looking. A backward K. And Porter with the strikeout. Out number 1 for KU here in the top of the 7th. BYU pitching numbers. Ben Hansen went 5. Jake Porter now 1 1/3. They combined to go 6 1/3 so far. Giving up 10 hits. 8 runs all earned. Striking out 5. Walking 2. 125 pitches thrown, so almost 50 more pitches thrown by BYU pitchers than Reese Dutton, who is dealing right now. A two-hop grounder to Beck, over to Vest, and on the 6-3 ground out, two out quickly here in the top of the seventh. Two gone, that was Michael Brooks grounding out. Luke Lido now bat out of the 8 hole. So Cranford strikes out looking, Brooks grounds out to short, and Lido on a 1-for-3 day. A strikeout, a double, after which he was stranded, and a ground out to second in the fifth. He now bats in the seventh with KU leading by 7, 8-1. Left-handed hitting, Luke Lido. What was that, Lido? He's going back to the dugout. Actually, it's Lido. He's being called back for a conference. So time briefly here in the top of the seventh. 8-1 KU. BYU one run on four hits. Kansas eight runs on 10 hits. They have the lone error due to the Jayhawks. BYU's playing much cleaner ball lately, defensively. The error's not an issue. It's other things after the error troubles came early in the season for BYU. Many more error-free games of late. All right, Porter to Lito. And Lito will one-hop that to Beck. He'll handle behind the second base bag. And a three-up, three-down inning for Kansas. A strikeout and a pair of ground outs, and we are now to the seventh inning stretch. For KU, no runs, no hits, no errors, and no one left on. We go bottom seven. Jayhawks 8, BYU 1 on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
It'll probably be something about togetherness, because it's a collaboration, not between pop stars and producers, but between music therapists and kids. Music therapy is a treatment that doesn't involve medication or needles, and it's been proven to help children manage pain and contribute to faster healing. So it shouldn't surprise you, it's our favorite song. And just one way we partner with you for a life well lived. Intermountain Health, the power of we.
As the world leader in essential oils, doTERRA's products help athletes around the world maintain the highest level of health and wellness. Our products are responsibly sourced and maximize performance, rest, and recovery for athletes at any level. doTERRA is proud to be the title sponsor of BYU Baseball and to support the student-athletes with their health and wellness goals. Learn more about how you can up your health and wellness game at doTERRA.com. doTERRA, pursue what's pure. Music of inspiration, messages of hope, and moments of reflection. Join us every Sunday on BYU Radio.
8:10:06.
Encouragement from religious leaders, stories from Scripture, and uplifting music. A moment to reflect in good faith. Music and the spoken word. Listen to our Sunday shows on demand at BYURadio.com. Or find them wherever you download your podcasts. Sundays are special on BYU Radio.
For more Cougar baseball, let's rejoin Greg Rubel.
Left-handed hitting Keone Painter leads off the BYU seventh, squares. Dutton comes off the mound, gets to first wide. A throwing error from Dutton will allow Painter to get to second. So Dutton, who moments ago handled the bunt attempt by Bryker Herdsman expertly, throws wildly, trying to get to Painter at first. And so second error of the day goes E1 and puts Painter at second to lead off the bottom of the seventh. Would have been tight, would have been close as Painter looking to bunt himself on here in the bottom of the seventh. And the throw wide of first, putting Painter at second on the overthrow, bringing up Chipper Beck out of the nine hole. Right-handed hitting Chipper Beck against the righty Reese Dutton. Dutton into his seventh inning. He's gone seven innings three times this year as the KU starter. And delivers strike one. Called strike slider at the far part of the zone. 0-1 to Beck. Beck today's 0-2. Fly out and a ground out in the second and the fourth. He bats now in the seventh and finds himself in an 0-2 hole. Off speed called strike. 0-2 to Chipper Beck. Painter is on second. So a runner in scoring position for Beck, who's batting 176 with runners in scoring position. His season average 170. The 0-2 from Dutton. Two glances back at second, comes plateward, and a three pitch out, swinging through. Strike three is Beck, and one gone for BYU. And that is a new season high in strikeouts for Dutton at 9 Ks on the day. Had an 8 strikeout game against TCU. That was a series win for the Jayhawks in Lawrence over the Horned Frogs, who still languish at the back of the Big 12 pack right now. 2-7 in Big 12 play. Surprising result, no doubt. As taking strike one is Luke Anderson. Back to the top of the order we go with one gone here in the bottom of the seventh. It's 8-1 Kansas. Painter's on second after reaching via E1. 0-1, 0-2. Luke swinging from the heels. As the rain picks up in intensity here, we've been off and on with the precipitation for the last 45 minutes to an hour, and more on than off, I would say. It's cold and damp here at Miller Park. The 0-2 mean time to Anderson. And lifts that in the air. The dead ball territory down the first baseline. We stay 0-2. Yeah, 53 degrees and drizzle right now. Tomorrow's forecast is pretty clear relative to precip, but Saturday it's back up to 50%. The outlook for rain, and softball's already decided to avoid Saturday and play two tomorrow against Houston. By the way, softball run ruling Houston behind us at Gale Miller Field a short time ago. 11-3 was the final after five. So softball the winner in game one of that series as Anderson fouls on the ground down the third baseline. Count remains 0-2. One gone, one on. The one on Painter at second. Bottom seven, 8-1 Jayhawks. KU's led all the way in this one. BYU's only run, courtesy of the Breiker Herdsman solo home run. Zions Bank home run in the fourth for BYU. Home run number 28 for BYU and home run number 4 on the year for Breiker. 1-2 meantime to Anderson. Luke's 2-for-3 today. Double, fly out, and a single. And a healthy hack. And shaking the right hand as he swung through strike three. And that's double-digit Ks now on the day for Reese Dutton. Season-high 10 strikeouts. And of the 10, 9 have been forward. Or of the swinging variety. Just one caught looking. Everyone else is swinging through Dutton's stuff today. Two gone for Crew Robinson. That's a ball piped in at 83 for a called strike. Strike one to Crew. Crew today is 1-for-3. His one was a single in the third. Lead-off single after which he was stranded. So runner on is Painter. And this number is the decisive one on the day. BYU is 0-for-14 with runners on. Kansas 7-for-18 with runners aboard. So one team hitting 389 and one team hitting triple aughts right now with traffic on the base paths. 0-2 count goes to 1-2 to Crew. Easton Jones on deck. BYU down 8-1 here, bottom seven. And Reese Dutton is dealing. He's one out away from matching his season-long inning outing of seven. Comes inside. Slider missing for ball two. 2-2 to Crew. Crew with hits in seven of his last eight games now with that single in the third. Two balls, two strikes. Two out, man on second is Painter. Took the barrel off the shoulder but held off and the count goes full. Haven't seen a whole lot of full counts from Reese Dutton. He's been very economical with his work. He's in the mid-90s right now, 95, 96 pitches thrown. The 3-2. And sky high to short right field. Shoji Naga, the second baseman back, and watching it into his glove for out number three. So a high pop up to end the seventh for BYU. No runs, no hits. There was an error, and one was left on. We go top eight, Kansas 8, BYU 1 on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Utah is a special place. Our communities, the people, history. There's no place quite like Utah. Siegfried and Jensen, we're honored to say that we are from Utah. We live here, work here, and when someone is injured, we're proud to say we've helped a neighbor when they've needed it most. We know Utah. At Siegfried and Jensen, we're here for you.
At Burger Supreme, it's all about the fry sauce. Our chefs have spent the last 375 years perfecting the one sauce to replace all others. Put it on your fries, your burgers, your chicken, your cereal. Dip your donuts in it. Wash your children with it. It truly is the one miracle cure for bursitis.
Sir, none of that's true yet.
Well, it's some darn good fry sauce.
Can't argue with that.
Burger Supreme, 1796 North University Parkway at Brigham's Landing.
Did you know that sharks have been around for 450 million years?
Really?
Did you know that the hashtag symbol is technically called an octothorpe?
Sounds French-Canadian.
Yeah. Did you know the 100-fold gloves and a chef's hat represent 100 ways to cook an egg.
You're kidding me.
And did you know that when you listen to the BYU Radio podcast, you can learn more fun facts and insights about the world around us? Download the BYU Radio app or listen wherever you get your podcasts.
Now that's good to know.
You're listening to BYU Baseball. Here's the voice of the Cougars, Greg Wrubell.
Chase Jans leads off the Kansas eighth. 8-1 Jayhawks. Jake Porter delivers fastball high for ball one. It's been Hansen and Porter for BYU. Two pitchers used. Reese Sutton's gone all the way for Kansas as Porter goes into a 2-0 hole to Jans. Jans today has grounded out to second, to third, and to short. So we're looking for an unassisted ground out to Cooper Vest here. A 2-0. Now we'll try short again. Ground ball to Beck. Over to Vest. And a second consecutive 6-3 ground out for Jans. Four ground outs on the day for the Kansas left fielder. He's 0 for 4 on the day. Top of the order, John Nett now. So we'll see if Reese Dutton comes out for the eighth. He hasn't gone longer than seven all year. He's had three games of seven innings pitched. Still under 100 pitches, I believe, at this point. He's at 95. So it would be his first game into the eighth should he come out for the eighth. His team leads 8-1. That's hit in the air deep to left field. Will it stay fair? It will. Into the Pines. 9-1 Jayhawks. John Nett with his first home run of the year. And second home run of the day for Kansas. Solo shot to lead off the eighth. And 9-1 Jayhawks. Nine runs on 11 hits. Round trooper for Nett. Yeah, nothing but Nett on that one. That was deep to left and just right of the 347 sign. Second dinger of the day. So Nett, who saw his 10-game hit streak end in his last game, maybe starts a new one in this one after going 0 for 4 on a strikeout, a flyout, and a pair of groundouts. That one was out of the park. 9-1 Jayhawks. Cody Shojinaga next batting for KU. Shojinaga today is 1 for 3 with a walk and a pair of runs scored. And KU's and the Big 12's leader in doubles has a double on the day. And KU as a team has 5 two-baggers. Of their 11 hits, 7 are for extra bases. That's to right center and will drop in front of the right fielder, Herdsman, for Shojinaga's second hit of the day. So a one-out single to right after a John Nett solo home run. And Shojinaga's second hit of the day gives the Jayhawks a base runner with one gone here in the top of the eighth and a 9-1 lead. So the two home runs today. Jake English, a two-run shot in the first, and John Nett's solo job here in the eighth. 9-1 Kansas. So KU with a win, should the result hold, would win its fourth consecutive Big 12 series opener and sixth consecutive series opener on the year. Their only series opening loss came to open the year. BYU 2-9 this year when allowing 6 or more runs, and they've allowed 9 so far. 9 runs on 12 hits. BYU 1 run on 5 hits. Let's get back into the count here to Ashby, 1-1. Goes to 1-2. Ashby, 5-7, 215 out of Aruba. Odessa College and New Mexico was previous schools. Left-handed hitting, Lenny Ashby in a 1-2 count. Porter kicks and fires. It's fouled back out of play. Count stays 1-2. Ashby today has an RBI single in his last at-bat. Before that, flied out, grounded out, and walked. Was then raced on the base pass on a 1-6 fielder's choice. So 1-4-3 today for Ashby. Lenny hitting 259 and hitting 310 with runners aboard. And he's got a runner on first in Shojinaga. And that's in the dirt away. 2-2 the count to Ashby. Ashby's reached base in 6 consecutive games. So Reese Dutton with a 9-1 lead has looked good on the hill as that's flied to center, and Painter will make the catch for out number 2. So he's won five straight starts coming into today. Should the result hold, Reese Dutton would win six consecutive starts and be the first pitcher to do that, dating back to at least 2003 for Kansas. In fact, with his 10 Ks today, he's the first KU pitcher with double-digit Ks in 3 years. Grounder to Beck, over to Robinson at second, and on the 6-4, the inning is over. And retired at second is Shoji Naga on the ground out there by Jake English. So that'll take us through 8.5. 9-1, KU the lead. KU one run on two hits. There were no errors. And one left on. We go bottom 8, 9-1 Jayhawks on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
When was the last time you had your teeth cleaned? Heart disease, Alzheimer's, stroke, dementia, and other inflammatory health conditions have been linked to periodontitis, a severe stage of gum disease. To help fight against gum disease and inflammatory health conditions, have your
nine,
teeth cleaned regularly by a dentist or hygienist. To review the science,
9-12,
go to visityourdentist.org. This message is brought to you by the eAssist Dental Health Education Foundation, reminding you that dental cleanings are essential for your health.
Cougar fans, it's time to gear up and get ready for BYU sports. The excitement is back and bigger than ever. We're taking on the Big 12. Are you geared up and ready to cheer them on? The BYU Store is the number one source for all your quality, authentic BYU gear.
Oh, you're starting to good to see you, brother.
Merch, game day tee,
oh, yeah, very hot. Be very careful.
Just
it's really
BYU
hot.
Players and coaches wear.
Good to see you, man.
The store, the stadium store,
I know what's happening.
BYUstore.com. For the widest selection of BYU clothing and accessories, the BYU Store, official outfitter of BYU fans everywhere.
This is BYU Cougars baseball on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Easton Jones leading off the BYU eighth. BYU down 8, 9-1. Easton Jones today 0-3. Pair of strikeouts and a flyout to right. Reese Dutton working into the eighth inning for the first time this year. And a little flare to center. A nice sliding grab made there by John Nett coming in on the ball in the air from Easton Jones. He was on his horse and then took a wet turf slide after handling that one off the shoe tops. Nice play by John Nett in center for out number one. So second fly out for Easton Jones today. He's 0-4. Brings up Cujillo Aloy. Cujillo's 0-3 today. Pair of strikeouts and a ground out to the pitcher. And so those 3-4 hitters who've combined for 12 home runs on the year, Jones and Aloy, are today 0-7 with 4 strikeouts. And that'll be on the ground into center, blooping over the second baseman's head, and it'll be a one-out single for Cujillo Aloy, his first hit of the day. Cooper Vass will now bat on an 0-2 day, hit by a pitch and was stranded in the first. Struck out swinging in the third and then flied out to right in the sixth. 10 strikeouts today for Reese Dutton. His season high. And again, KU's first double-digit strikeout performance in some 3 seasons. Dutton's through 7 1/3. New season-long outing for Dutton. And BYU's getting almost nothing against Dutton today. 9-1 is the score. One run on 6 hits for BYU. 9 runs on 12 hits for KU. 1-0 the count meantime to Cooper Vest, left-handed hitting Vest against the righty Dutton. Let's see if BYU can get its first hit with a runner on. The Cougs are 0-15 today with runners aboard. 2-0 and Aloy on first. Foul back out of play, 2-1. Yeah, that's a tough one to swallow. 0-15 runners on, 0-7 runners in scoring position. Meantime, KU's going 7-20 and 5-14 in those two categories respectively, hitting in the 300s, high 300s, and BYU's at triple zeros in both categories. The 2-1, Fouled up and out of play down the third baseline. 2-2 the count goes to Vastkoop today. That 0-for-2 on the hit by pitch, a strikeout and a flyout. Bryker Herdsman, who's accounted for the Cougs' lone run, is on deck. It was home run number 4 for Bryker. Solo shot in the fourth. Made it a 5-1 game. Jayhawks have since added 4 for the 9-1 lead. And a swinging strikeout. 11 Ks on the day now for Reese Dutton. And 2 down for BYU. And of the 11 strikeouts, 10 have been swinging. So Dutton is really earning his Ks on the day. BYU in Big 12 play does lead the league in strikeouts. By its batters, of course. 0-1 foul back to the screen by Herdsman. The 0-1 to Bryker. Piped in for 0-2. And Dutton again works ahead. Yeah, BYU is the only Big 12 team coming into the day with more than 100 strikeouts. They were at 105. And now BYU's up to 116 on the day. Make it 117. And strikeout number 12 for Reese Dutton. Swinging through strike three is Bryker Herdsman. Two more strikeouts in the inning. And Dutton's been dominant through 8. The lead is 8. KU 9, BYU 1 going top 9 next on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Attention BYU fans, are you ready to elevate your Cougar pride to new heights? Join the Cougar Club now and be part of an exclusive community that fills the roles that bind our teams. Enjoy priority seating and parking, exclusive events and other unique benefits, and experience a renewed sense of camaraderie. Your support makes a difference. BYU's 623 student athletes. Join the Cougar Club today and be part of the heartbeat of BYU athletics. Learn more at CougarClub.com.
I'm unique, and so are my financial needs. That's why when Zions Bank says they're dedicated to valuing you, supporting you, serving you, understanding you, protecting you. What they're really saying is they're dedicated to providing me with tools and services designed to meet my unique financial needs, no matter what stage of life I find myself in. It's just one of the many ways Zions Bank is for you and for me. A division of Zions Bank Corporation, N.A., member FDIC, equal housing lender, NMLS number 467014.
One thing that I hope sticks with our listeners, which is not just the feeling of I love knowing something I can do that I didn't know I could do. And it's as simple as saying, that person really has been for my neighbor. One simple thing I could do, even to just stand outside and say, I'm glad you're here.
Open your mind and heart with a good faith whenever you get your podcasts.
This is BYU Cougars Baseball on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Well, BYU's had base runners today. They just haven't had scorers. 9-1 is the Kansas lead heading into the ninth inning. As Reese Dutton has shut BYU down when the Cougs get on the bases. BYU 0-for-17 with runners aboard today as we go to the ninth inning. And leading off for the Jayhawks is Ben Hartle. Faces a new BYU pitcher. Peyton Gubler is in, bringing us to a PZ Printing pitching change. Brought to you by PZ Printing. Nothing inspires like print. Gubler 0-1. Gubler 1-1 now to Ben Hartle. Peyton making his sixth appearance, an 11.81 ERA in 5 1/3 coming into the day inside for ball 2. Gubler 7 hits, 9 runs, 7 of them earned, has struck out 7, walked 8. Batters hitting 304 against Gubler's given up 2 home runs in 5 1/3. And 3 straight balls, 3-1 now the count to Ben Hartle. Hartle hit by a pitch and scored in the first. Doubled home run in the third. Was hit by a pitch and was stranded in the fifth and grounded out in the sixth. Opposite field, will it get down in front of Herdsman? It'll be a gapper to the wall for Ben Hartle. Hartle grinding and ending up at second for another Kansas double. That is 6 doubles on the day. And of the 13 hits for KU today, 8 have been for extra bases. 6 doubles and 2 dingers. 9 runs, 13 hits for KU. BYU 1 run on 6 hits. The Cougar run generation has been stifled by the dominant work of Dutton. And his day is done as that wild pitch gets past Parker Goff, and going second to third is Hartle. So leadoff double by Hartle. He ends up at third on the wild pitch. Collier Crawford is the batter. Crawford today is 1-for-4 with an RBI double, a ground out and a pair of strikeouts, one swinging, one looking. Again, just last week he was a cycle hitter against UCF. The 1-0 goes to 2-0, two outside pitches to Crawford. 9 multi-hit games on the year, looking to be the first Jayhawk to 10 multi-hit games, I believe, if he can find a hit here in the ninth. 9-1 is the lead. Hartle's on third, 90 feet away. And that'll be a grounder deep in the hole to Beck. The run will score on the throw to first. It's an RBI ground out for Collier Crawford, who's scoring his Hartle on the 6-3. And that's run number 10 on the day for Kansas. 10-1 Kansas here, top 9. Michael Brooks will now bat with one gone and no one aboard. Fastball called strike. Gubler gets 0-1 to Brooks. 10-1 Kansas. BYU gave up 15 to UVU on Monday and 10 so far today against Kansas. And we are in a lightning delay, I do believe. So with one gone here in the top of the ninth, I heard rumbling thunder, and the skies look foreboding to the south. They've darkened, and apparently lightning in the vicinity. So we are in a delay here at Miller Park. And unfortunately, the way this game is going, it appears like we're delaying the inevitable relative to the outcome. We'll give the Cougars their due. They've got 3 more outs to work with in the bottom of the ninth when we get there, if and when we get there. It's 10-1 Kansas. We're in the top of the ninth with one out and an 0-1 count to Michael Brooks when we heard the thunder. And then the operations folks came on the field and said we're in a lightning delay, and the players and umpires have now headed for their clubhouses, and we will take a break as well. Let's break for a minute. We'll come back and set things up for you. We may take a longer delay on BYU Radio before we return to play baseball. Let's take a break for 60. We'll come back to Provo in a moment on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Spot for fresh, flavorful, and fantastic food. Locally owned and operated since 1989, Burger Supreme is more than just fast food. It's great food, great service, and great value. Whether you're in the mood for chicken, fish, a great sandwich or salad, or of course, a mouth-watering burger, Burger Supreme will not disappoint. And don't forget the fry sauce. It's amazing. Burger Supreme, 1796 North University Parkway at Brigham's Landing.
You're listening to BYU Baseball. Here's the voice of the Cougars, Greg Rubel.
With one out in the top of the ninth and Kansas leading by 9, the score 10-1, we are in a weather delay. It's been raining for much of the afternoon, but now thunder and lightning have become involved. And so for the time being, we're going to break to regularly scheduled programming on BYU Radio, and then we'll come back to Provo with an update and or the end of this game, whichever transpires the most quickly, and we'll have that be our game plan for now. So on 10 runs and 13 hits, Kansas leads BYU 10-1 on 1 run and 6 hits for the Cougars. We're in the top of the ninth, one out and an 0-1 count to Michael Brooks. That's when play was halted due to weather. So we'll go to regularly scheduled BYU Radio programming, and then we'll come back with more, we hope, from Miller Park on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
Dead.
parents or their trusted adults in their world are the safe people to turn to ask for help and support. Here in Australia, we survey young people that we work with, and we found out that 1 in 3 young people will turn to a parent first if something went wrong for them online. That means 2 in 3 kids wouldn't speak to their parents if something was going wrong for them online. And we really wanted to interrogate why that was the case. And one of the big reasons is that they're scared that their parents are going to flip out if they tell them that something goes wrong. Or they're also worried that their parents are going to take the devices away from them if they've maybe made a mistake online. So I do think we need to be thinking differently about our dispositions around technology conversations with our children. And if we can be talking positively and openly about technology and how we're using it, the challenges that we might be personally facing as grown adults using technology, are all small ways that over time we can build their capacity and understanding about why it's so important to stay safe online, but also how we can do it too.
There's sometimes this tendency, or there was with me back in the day, to say something like, well, this is all too much. It's just too much time, brain space, and certainly too many different gaming systems and cords and accessories, and none of them are compatible, and you always have to buy a new system. I don't know. It's not worth it. It's just a hassle. So let's just not mess with any of it, right? And I get that tendency. It's not like buying a board game in a box. It's HDMI cords and mess, and there's the time of regulating it and understanding it. And then when I had relented thinking, well, okay, it's just games, it was suddenly online and strangers can play with you. What? When did that happen? And it sounds horrible, but you don't know anything about it because you've never played it. You didn't grow up with this kind of technology. That's how I felt when it first all unfolded with my kids. My kids, unknowing to me, were playing on an open server before I even knew what that meant. That was a huge mistake. I asked my oldest, who taught himself coding, which is so smart, but again, completely out of my comfort zone, to sort of hold off once I understood what that meant. And we talked about my fears and him not having any fears. And after our conversation, he decided that the best option was to set up a private server for our family and friends, people that we know in real life, to play. Now, my oldest, Miles, taught me how to evaluate technology better by asking me calmly, you know, at like 12, what are you afraid of? And I would say something reasonable like, well, I'm afraid of you guys talking to a bunch of creeps online who are either gonna steal your identity or your innocence and then find out where we live and kidnap you and show you gross things. And because those were the things that I was really scared of at that time. And how funny is that? Because now I'm scared about a lot of different things. Anyway, that's another topic. Miles wasn't worried about that because he was confident of his skills, but in my estimation, underestimated the emotional and social, you know, power of his 14-year-old self. So we continued to have these kinds of conversations. It's not just about not buying the stuff or setting time limits on how much they play. It's having the conversations. Why are you going online? What are the reasons? What do you get out of it? Is it helping you reach your goals in life? Is it helping you become a good person? Are you being smart? Are you being safe? So now my kids will answer those kinds of questions because they seem to have a real answer instead of just an answer that's concerned with control. My kids know that if they answer those questions to me confidently, that I'll be satisfied. But it's this ongoing trust and conversation that is the real intensity of monitoring our identity online. And this is the tricky part of parenting. You know, we're never gonna be totally perfect about this because we're never gonna be perfect about any aspect of parenting. But building that trust is just as much about admitting our own failures or ignorance as it is about sharing what we do know. Trent had some specific advice for handling the mistakes that we'll make, both parents and kids, along the way.
Well, I think that the key word is mistakes, and we're all human and we sometimes make them. And one of the best things I think we can do as parents for our children is to tell our kids that there's no thing that you would ever say or do that I wouldn't forgive, or a mistake that we couldn't work together to solve. And I think if we can have that conversation with our kids, that will build their trust to come and talk to us if something goes wrong. And maybe even showing them some of the mistakes that you made, because it's real to them. It becomes a story, it becomes more contextualized, But if you can say, well, I've decided to remove that post of our house where it has our house number on it because it's not safe for us to have our address online, that's an introduction to the conversation about, well, why is it not safe to have a photo of our house on the internet? So that you can start that why conversation. So many kids tell us today that, you know, parents are telling us, be safe, don't do this, don't do that online. But what about the why conversation? Why is it not safe for us to behave that way online? And if we can help them understand that, that empowers them to make better choices.
These mistakes that Trent is talking about can be obvious, encountering something inappropriate online or falling for a scam. But they can also be subtle and not as easy to detect. Like I mentioned earlier, online safety is a lot more than just protecting your passwords. There are things that on the surface don't seem bad, but that over time will be corrosive to our mental and emotional health. So in order to get the full picture of how to be safe online, I talked to mental health educator and author Natasha Devon to complement the advice that we heard from Trent. Here she is explaining one way that using social media can impact our mental health.
Well, it's interesting because I think when most people hear the words online safety, they think of things like having two-factor authentication on your apps and not clicking on phishing links on emails. They think of keeping your information safe, whereas I'm much more concerned with our emotional safety online. And that has to do with how much we are happy to share. And our understanding of how far the information we put out about ourselves on the internet can travel, who can see it, how it can be used, and the impact that being part of this, you know, thinking about this in relation to mental health and my work in advocacy, something that I had to do was I had to create a version of my story that is true. It's all completely truthful, what I share when I'm talking to young people and at events. But it's not all-encompassing. It doesn't include every single trauma I've ever had in my life. It gives an overview of my story. It gives a narrative that hopefully will help the audience to learn something. And I had to do that because sharing your story over and over again and talking about things in your life that have had a really profound impact on you can be an exercise in kind of re-traumatizing yourself over and over and over again. And I think in a way, the act of being online is an act of creating a version of your story that is as authentic as it can be without having to revisit things that you're not necessarily ready to revisit. And I think one of the most common pitfalls is seeing an online conversation and thinking, I am perfectly placed to contribute to this because I've been through that, or they're describing my struggle or my identity, but not taking a moment to think, am I ready to have this conversation, or is it still too raw for me to be able to do that?
I love the way Natasha frames the decision to share online. It's not just about whether you're sharing delicate personal information or not, but it's also about how sharing this information will affect your mental health. I asked Natasha for advice on knowing when to share.
Sometimes it's okay to sit this one out. That's a piece of advice that I would give. So to give you an example of something that's happened really recently, yesterday here in the UK, one of our politicians, a very high profile politician who is a black woman, made some comments in a national newspaper which many people consider to be anti-Semitic. And I'm sitting there going, okay, I have black elements of my heritage, I have Jewish elements to my heritage. I have so many thoughts. I've done so much deep thinking on this issue. And then I looked at some of the conversation around this news story and I thought, actually, do I want to put myself through that with people who haven't done deep thinking, people who are bringing their own experiences and their own traumas to the table, people who are angry, actually, and want to express their anger online? Maybe I'll just sit this one out. And it's a really useful piece of advice, I think, for any young person to go, do you know what? You don't have to jump in with both feet straight away whenever there's a trend, whether it's on TikTok or Instagram or whatever it is. Sometimes it's okay to opt out.
Now, something that I've learned, especially in the last few years of tense online political conversations, is that this can be extra complicated when it comes to topics that hit close to home. We'll be right back.
BYU Radio.
Together.
Hey everyone, this is Lauren McLean for Her Why, where we celebrate the women who make BYU sports great.
Going to BYU, I felt like I still had so much to prove. I kind of felt like an underdog once again.
My dad always said, he's like, I'm not going to be the person that makes you guys great. You guys are.
I know who I am, and I know who God thinks I am. And so that's what matters the most to me.
You can listen to all episodes of Her Why on the BYU Radio app or wherever you listen to podcasts.
Meet Marcus Smith, host of Constant Wonder.
I've given a lot of thought over my time behind a microphone with guests, and I've thought about the centrality of the ethical gesture of hospitality, where it's not just going after right perspectives, who's going to win the argument. It has to do with never pulling apart the good from the true from the beautiful, in the old Platonic sense, and hospitality is part of the good.
Listen to The Good on Constant Wonder, wherever you get your podcasts.
Welcome to The Lisa Show. There are certain parts of my identity or things that I feel so strongly about because they personally affect me and my kids that I immediately have my senses up when I encounter them online. So things like my religion or sexual orientation or political beliefs that I feel really strongly about, those kinds of flags immediately give me an emotional response. And then I read what is said about it. And that secondary response makes me a little bit more invested in whatever is being said. If I feel like anyone is saying anything remotely negative about me or my family and what we hold dear, our personal beliefs and the way that we want to live our lives, it is really hard for me to respond in a measured way. And I think that's true of all of us, that when we have a strong emotional response to something online, it can be more tempting to engage in a way that is unhealthy or unsafe. I love what Natasha had to say about this. Here she is.
There's a brilliant book actually by an author called Ashley Dottie Charles, and it's called Outraged: Why Everybody's Shouting and No One's Talking. And she encourages us to see our outrage as like currency in the bank. You have to spend it wisely. So she, you know, sets out her stall at the beginning by saying she is a black lesbian. So she's a woman, she's a lesbian, and she's black. So she says, you know, if I was outraged by everything that is outrageous in the context of those three communities that I belong to, I would be outraged all the time and I would burn out and I would very quickly become exhausted. So what she has chosen to do instead is just to pick the issue or a couple of issues that she is most passionate about, where she can bring about tangible change, and focus her energies on those things. And I always say that, particularly to the teenagers that I work with, a lot of them are really into activism and they want to use their voice online to bring about change. And I think it's wonderful that they have that enthusiasm for that. But I always say to them, okay, but pick the thing that you're going to invest in and try to see the rest as almost like white noise. You can see it like a patchwork quilt. There's a very famous quote that I forget, but it's about feminism, and it's we all have our square, and when you sew it all together, it creates this patchwork quilt that is all encompassing. But you only have to focus on your square. You don't have to do everything all at once.
I love Natasha's advice for becoming advocates on subjects that we feel passionately about while still staying safe and protecting our emotional health. Now, something that's been a struggle for my kids for a long time has been finding role models. I mean, we all know the big joke about how all kids now want to be a famous TikTok, you know, influencer. And some of the information that comes out of influencers, and specifically male artists and musicians and rappers that have come out in recent years, have really emotionally impacted my kids. They have been devastated to find out that their favorite musicians have failed in some moral way, or turned out to be somebody that they didn't think that they were. And they've had a real hard time trying to come to terms with, well, should I still listen to this artist? Do I still follow them and like them? Or am I becoming complicit in this kind of behavior? And these are interesting questions, especially online, to have as people report different information, finding out what's true, and then being able to deal with it. But what I've been surprised with is the real emotional response and sort of this distance that my kids have had of saying, oh, well, is everyone awful? Where are the role models? And being able to have those kinds of discussions about who we look up to and why, and what kind of art we consume and why, and our reasoning behind that has taken up a lot of mental health conversations in our home, much more than I ever had with my parents. I asked Natasha about what advice she has for young people looking for someone to look up to.
This is a really important aspect to the discussion, I think. And I think for any adult in a young person's life, the tendency can be to dismiss role models because you don't understand what they are offering to young people or what young people are getting out of them. And therefore, the conversation is not necessarily very productive. So we had this recently with, we had a very misogynistic online influencer who gained an enormous amount of traction with boys and young men in particular. And what was happening was teenage boys were asking their teachers in assemblies what they thought about this influencer and then recording it secretly and then posting it to TikTok and tagging the influencer in it in a kind of, look, you're being talked about way, and thus kind of adding to the traction that he was getting online. So I think actually a better approach, and certainly the approach that I took, was to say in as non-judgmental way as possible, okay, what is it that this guy is offering you that you think is valuable? And, you know, boys were telling me that they often were feeling anxious and like they didn't understand what their place was in the world. And here was somebody who was giving them a very structured, very simple set of rules to live by. And it's like, okay, well, if that's what you need, let's point you in the direction of other people who will give you that structure that you're craving, but not in a misogynistic way with this kind of hateful philosophy and hateful ideology attached. So I pointed them in the direction of some other male role models online who, you know, would be better for them overall. So it is, you know, it's really difficult because there's 3 billion people on the internet and some of them are incredible role models and some of them aren't. But I think we always need to start from a place of curiosity rather than judgment when having those discussions with young people.
I love that idea from Natasha of starting from curiosity rather than judgment, which I also heard on Ted Lasso. We're all looking for connection, and the internet can be a wonderful place to meet new people from different walks of life. And yet, again, we have a loneliness epidemic that's cutting years off of our lives, as much as heavy smoking. And our teenage girls, especially, are more depressed and anxious than ever before. So we're not using technology in a way that's good. I particularly have felt that during the pandemic, like lots of people. But after the death of my husband, I felt a loneliness in a different way that I haven't ever felt before. And I found some widow support groups and some widow support groups outside of my religious tradition and within my religious tradition as a way to connect with people who have been through what I've been and are going through what I'm going through. And connecting with them online, there was something about that sort of anonymity but also closeness that has helped me feel connected in a way that I wouldn't have another way, because I just know myself that I wouldn't walk into an in-person widower support group without at least making sure that I knew what sort of the environment was before I went in, which is exactly what I did. And so this online community facilitated a way for me to meet other widows and widowers in real life. And that kind of connection, that example of just using technology as a way to introduce me, a real connection that I was looking for that I could not find in my real life, is a success story for me. And I know that other people have experiences like that. It's why we're drawn to it. But whether it's a support group online or a dating site or an Etsy site, it all requires a certain level of vulnerability, and that can lead to potentially unsafe situations. When we've all heard stories of extreme cases like catfishing or predators, I asked Natasha how she suggests approaching meeting new people online. Here's what she had to say.
Well, I think the first and most important thing to, in terms of newbies to the online environment of any age, but particularly children and young people, is to understand that people are not who they say they are online. And that can be in the most obvious sense of somebody can adopt an entirely new identity, but it can also be in terms of we edit out anything about ourselves that we think is imperfect or embarrassing or a flaw in how we show up online. So when we are forming connections, I always think of it as like you're sending in your representative into the online space. So your representative is forming a connection with somebody else's representative. And that doesn't mean that that connection can't be valuable, but it does mean that it leaves you a little bit vulnerable in terms of what else you might discover about that person. So it's important to hold a little bit back. And I think as well, there's this, this is not strictly related to what you asked, but it's kind of following on from what I just said. There's a tendency to buy wholesale into online role models or people you form a relationship with online. And you're like, I love them, I love everything about them, I love everything they do. And then the minute they do something that falls outside of that idea of them that you have created in your head, you go, okay, I hate them now. You know, people are imperfect. I always say it's okay to say, I admire this about this person. I love this aspect of their work. I love this aspect of their character or their personality. That's what I really respect and admire. But that doesn't mean that they are my personal guru.
Ultimately, it can be so hard to keep up with what's changing. From new social media platforms, to new tech, to new scams, to new ways to make genuine friends online. It often feels like an impossible challenge to try and stay ahead of it all when it comes to our kids. Trent told me about a specific mnemonic, content, collection, and connection, that can help us identify unsafe online spaces.
The number one thing that we encourage parents to do is to make sure that you've got enough of an open relationship with your child that you, A, understand how they're using that technology when they are playing, and making sure that we're supervising them in communal and open spaces, particularly for young children. The second thing that we really encourage you to do is to know that one game or social network that your child uses and look out for three things. The three things that you need to look out for: the content that they're going to see and be exposed to, so a quick Google search, a YouTube video on that tool or website or game, first and foremost. So what content will they see and be exposed to? Secondly, we want to look out for what information is collected about our kids. So the three C's I'm using, so content, collection, and connection. So the collection is, you know, what kind of questions does it ask my young person when they're signing up to build an online profile for a game or a social network? And then the third thing is, how can people connect with my child? If we know how that tool works, we also will be able to find and locate privacy settings, well-being settings that we can switch on and turn off to help our child set them up safely. And we encourage parents to do that with their children.
I love Trent's mnemonic. First, understand the content that our kid is consuming in this specific online space. Second, understanding the collection that is happening. What information or data is that space collecting from your child? And third, understand the connection that is happening in that space. Who is your child interacting with, and who is reaching out to them? Identifying the content, collection, and connection of any new social media platform or video game will give us a groundwork for keeping our kids in a safe, constructive space. You know, there are other ways, of course, that I want to keep my kids safe online, but I find that most of my conversations with other parents about the dangers of technology tend to focus on the amount of screen time and what they're doing, like when and how to check content. Like, we're trying to catch them doing something that we suspect they're doing, or if the game or text messaging is appropriate to our family standards. It's the worst feeling to catch them doing something you know isn't good, because then what? I think they're the wrong conversations. The real conversations and questions are, why are we going online? What are we looking for? recreation, numbing pain, looking for connection, friendships, validation? And what are the effects? Or is it working? Or are they feeling, as the data suggests, loneliness, poor body image, comparison, depression, and anxiety? The tipping point, the usage, the time and content will have a different effect on different kids and ourselves. We can't follow a prescribed list of do's and don'ts and expect it to have the same effect on each kid and then wash our hands of the problem. Not just because every kid is different, but because the technology and apps and games and all of it are constantly changing. So these are the conversations that we need to be having with our kids. The day is over where we just monitor everything and expect them to obey. The days of control are over. But the good news is that the kinds of conversations that we have will build trust, will build relationships, will have us connected to each other in real life even more and use the best of technology. And with that in mind, I think that if we're going to be that intentional and deliberate about understanding how our kids are using the internet, why wouldn't we be just as careful about our own usage? Whatever new changes happen year after year, I know that we can be prepared to stay as safe as possible. Safe not only in what information we share and with whom, but also safe in how we let the internet affect our mental and emotional health. And I know that you're worth it, and so is your family, and your mental health deserves to be protected just as much as your passwords. We'll be right back.
BYU Radio. Together.
We have more in common than we have that differentiates us. And this God's love is, I think, the essence and the foundation. He doesn't say, I only like you or you. God's love embodies everyone.
This week, as part of our three-episode miniseries on God's love, a thoughtful panel discussion with Buddhist, Baha'i, and Christian perspectives. Sunday on BYU Radio and the In Good Faith podcast.
Life is complicated. The hustle and bustle of the world we live in can be overwhelming. Here at BYU Radio, we understand and want to help you cut through the clutter and noise. Knowledge, direction, enlightenment, virtue, redemption, empathy, kindness, understanding, entertainment, positivity. Words to describe your listening experience. Download the BYU Radio app or listen wherever you get your podcasts and let the journey begin.
Welcome to the Lisa Show Book Club. We're really excited that you're here. We have Shantae and Alexis. Thank you so much for being here.
You're welcome.
Today, we are joining our conversation on Alone Together by Sherry Turkle, and we're talking about... This really is part three, but we're talking about chapters 5, 6, and 7 today. And if you haven't gone back and seen part 1 and 2, please do. We had some really great discussions about really the foundation and the beginning of this book. And so I want to dive into part three today. And really, in going over three chapters, I was trying to think of, like, what do these three chapters sort of have in common? And I really think that it begs the questions of, like, how can we hope for technology to do for it? You know, what is it, our hope for robots, for technology, for our connection? Like, do we want the right kind of things? Are we asking the right kind of questions? And before we started, we were just having a really fun conversation about how sometimes we think, you know, we have the right sort of mind frame, like with our kids and stuff, like, don't do that, do this. It's so easy for us to tell. But it's hard to tell, like, when you're in the middle of it, when you're in the thick of it. And we don't really have a lot of hindsight with technology. And I really like when it starts right out with complicities, that artificial intelligence between a mechanical view of people and a psychological, even spiritual view of machines. And I wondered what you really like thought about like the overall ideas of why we have machines and what we hope we can do with them.
Oh, I think that's brilliant, honestly.
Listen, this is why we have you.
But I did feel like when I was writing it and just thinking of my life in real time, I was like, okay, life just seems so busy, we're going in so many directions, that I would want it to support the areas that don't need human connection so I have more time for more human connection. passion. But it seems like we're trying to replace it and use it to, like, I don't know, get more human connection, but it's not human at all. And so I think that that's where I could recognize, even in my own life, where maybe I have it flipped, where I'm like, when is it convenient and provides more time for family, friends, and connection and deep relationships, and when is it taking away from that?
Yeah, that's an important distinction.
Yeah, no, that's really sort of where my mind was going. I'm just like, it's such a brilliant invention, right? It's,
yeah.
It does so much, and even just reading these chapters and how children are connected to them, but my mind kept going, there's a deeper need. You know what I mean?
Yeah, especially for kids.
Yes, especially for kids. And I have so much mom guilt around electronics and technology. It eats me alive. But then there are times where I'm like, this is really useful. It's serving a purpose. I think it's separating that is the purpose to fill a human void. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Or is the purpose outside of that that's actually really beneficial?
Yeah, I was so struck with when they introduced like new robots, you know. Sherry with this book talks a lot of case studies, right? And she's like, okay, so I gave these robots to these kids and this is how they responded. And I was so struck by like how they wanted the robots to love them.
Yes.
They like, as an adult, we kind of play along and we might be deceived, but we sort of go in and out of it. But the kids are like, do you think it likes me best? And things like they're looking for, just like they're looking, you know, when they're like looking for our approval and attention as parents and as adults and things like that. And they're trying to make that like kind of initial connection. And a lot of times, like, I'm the same way. Like, I feel this mom guilt about like, oh, I think, did I give that kid a phone too early? And are they on the internet too? And my kids are older now, and so it's like, well, I'm gonna have to live with it.
Yeah,
you know, so I'm sort of like dealing with it now, but it was sort of like half and half, right?
Yeah,
like when
yeah.
my older kids were older, and then I made mistakes, and then I changed my mind. But I do notice, though, that all of our conversations are about like the time that our kids are on it,
yes.
not the reason why. And I think intent means everything. I really do.
Yes, it does. And we were both just talking as we drove here about our kids, when they get really stressed, it's like they want it as a decompression and a distraction. But then it's like, well, are we teaching them coping skills to not have to turn to that like zone out? Mm-hmm. I do it. I want Netflix at 11 o'clock at night, you know? And so it's like, but what coping things are we skipping? And just the awareness of being distracted, but being there. And I think you can see how the kids wanted that connection with a robot, but they want that with us also, where it's like, we might be in the room, but if our mind is somewhere else, or we're not making eye contact or engaging, the kids are feeling that, and it's making them question. Just like with a robot, it's like, oh, do they love me? What do they think of me? And it's so
fascinating. It's interesting, their response to indifference.
Yes.
Like if they felt like
it was worse.
Yes, it was worse to that indifference. And I'm like, as a parent, do we ever come off that way? If we're distracted doing other things, how are they internalizing it? It was really interesting.
Ooh, yeah. And how does that affect their development? Because I think it's one thing for us to be able to do with our life experience behind us. But as kids are developing and developing their brains, what kind of adults will they be? And what will they expect from human relationships if they're, you know, raised by robots? And I know that sounds so dramatic, like, but like we're already dealing with things we never thought we would. Like during COVID, like we all were online, and our kids were all online a lot more than they normally are. No matter what, we all were. And if you compound that,
you're listening to BYU Baseball. Here's the voice of the Cougars, Greg Rubel.
All right, after a weather delay, we are back and on the air. BYU Radio, 107.9 FM, the BYU Radio app, and BYURadio.org. Many also following along on the BYU Cougars YouTube channel today. No ESPN, ESPN Plus broadcast with the change in game time from evening to afternoon, so the BYU Cougars YouTube feed's been activated, synced up with our radio call. And if that's how you're enjoying the game with us today, well, welcome back. We had a weather delay with some lightning in the area after rain throughout much of the afternoon. And we come back to a 10-1 ball game. Kansas leading BYU 10-1. We're in the top of the ninth, one out, and the count 0-1 to Michael Brooks when we resume. And we will resume here in just a moment with no real warm-ups to be had beyond the tosses the players just took off to the side moments ago. So no traditional pregame warm-ups will be coming up. They'll get right back and underway. 10-1 Jayhawks. They scored four in the first. A Jake English two-run home run, a Collier Cranford double, and a Michael Brooks single bringing home four. It was 4-0 after one. KU got one more in the third with a Ben Hartle double scoring Jake English. It was 5-0. Jayhawks to the bottom of the fourth. In the bottom of the fourth, Bryker Herdsman led off the inning with a solo home run. It was 5-1 then. Kansas in the lead. Top of the fifth, a Michael Brooks single scoring Jake English. It was then 6-1 KU. Two more in the sixth on a Lenny Ashby single and a Jake English single. It was then 8-1 after six. One more in the eighth on a John Nett home run to left field, a solo shot, and a run already scoring in the ninth this inning. After leading off, Ben Hartle with a double. Collier Cranford scored him with an RBI ground out after Hartle advanced to third on a wild pitch. So after all that, 10-1 is our score as we come back into play here at Miller Park. On the hill for BYU remains Peyton Gubler. It's been Ben Hansen. He's the pitcher of record for BYU in terms of taking the loss on the day. Jake Porter after Hansen, and then Peyton Gubler, the third pitcher used. KU's only used one pitcher, but his day will be done. Reese Dutton went a dominant eight. We'll see who the Jayhawks bring out for the ninth inning. Let's get to our Explore Utah Valley Big 12 scoreboard on the day. Love BYU sports, but miss being near the action? Fly PVU for game day fun only 6 miles from campus. Downtown hotels and restaurants nearby. Find your happy here. Learn more at utahvalley.com. It's the Explore Utah Valley Big 12 scoreboard as we explore the scoreboard. No scores yet, but this is the schedule for tonight. Texas Tech will be visiting UCF. Texas at Kansas State, Houston at TCU, Cincy at Baylor, and Lamar will play at Oklahoma as OU is the only one of 13 Big 12 teams to be out of league on this day. So six conference series and one out-of-conference series. That is your Big 12 scoreboard brought to you by Explore Utah Valley. All right, we're back to play. Michael Brooks stepping back into the batter's box in an 0-1 count facing Peyton Gubler. 10-1, the Jayhawks with a lead of 9 here in the top of the ninth. And our weather delay is over. The rain has ceased, still cool and wet, but here we go. And the 0-1 goes to 1-1. Fastball in tight and up top on Michael Brooks. Brooks, pair of RBI today. Run scoring singles in both the first and the fifth. That'll go to 2-1. Fastball inside from Gubler. 2-for-4 today for Brooks with those two RBI. That's ball three away. Three balls and a strike, one gone, and no one on. Here, top nine. That's driven to deep left center and over the wall for the third home run of the day. That's how the Jayhawks come out of the delay, with Michael Brooks going yard for the third time today, his third hit on the day, the Jayhawks' third home run of the day. And 11-1, Jayhawks take a 10-run lead here in the top of the ninth. Two-run ninth as they've scored in back-to-back innings. It'll bring up Luke Leto. So three home runs for the visitors, a single home run for BYU. Of the 14 hits for Kansas, nine extra base hits. Six doubles and three home runs. Left-handed batting Leto. With one gone, the 0-1 goes to 0-2, so two straight strikes delivered by Peyton Gubler. The 0-2. And a backward K, a three-strike punch out. And Leto is down on strikes for the second time today. He struck out swinging in the first and now looking in the ninth. Two gone for the nine-hole hitter, Chase Jans. Two runs scoring here in the ninth for Kansas. 11-1 is our score. Grounder sliding to it as Crew Robinson pops up, fires over to Cooper Vest at first, and on that 4-3 ground out, the inning is over. But in the ninth, including a lengthy weather delay, two runs on to the bottom of the ninth. Parker Goff, Keone Painter, and Chipper Beck, 7, 8, 9 hitters due up here in the bottom of the ninth. Back at Larry H. Miller Field, Miller Park in Provo, Utah. Got a lengthy weather delay in the top of the ninth. We came out of the delay with a Michael Brooks solo home run, the Jayhawks' 11th run of the day. New pitcher for the Jayhawks, as Reese Dutton's day is done, Hunter Cachero. The 1-0 from Cachero to Goff goes to 2-0. Hunter making his fifth appearance of the year. He's gone five innings. He's given up nine hits, three runs all earned, a struck out three, walked three. 5.40 ERA. Batters hitting 375 against Cachero. 2-0. Lifted back out of play. Foul by Goff. 2-1 the count. It was a 91-mile-per-hour heater from Hunter Cachero. Tomorrow we'll have a doubleheader. They've already looked ahead to the weather and said we won't play Saturday. We'll play two tomorrow. So 1 o'clock and roughly 4:30, and both games on BYU Radio 107.9 FM, the BYU Radio app, and BYURadio.org, as Parker Goff gets plunked on a fastball inside. And so Goff will take first base here in the bottom of the ninth. Keone Painter will now bat for BYU. Keone today is 0-for-2 with a walk. Reached on an E1, was stranded in the seventh. Left-handed hitter against the righty Hunter Cachero. Goff on first. Called strike at 90. Home plate umpire Christopher Griffith on the call. Matt McKendry at first. Doug Williams at second. Joshua Nolan at third. That will be our crew for the weekend, which will be a two-day weekend. Now two games tomorrow. 0-1. Changeup missing. Ball one. The book on Cachero, three-pitch mix, fastball, slider, change. The 1-1. And a nice fastball lower part of the frame, called strike two. 1-2 to Painter. And that's off speed, evens the count of 2-2. About three of every balls throw, four balls thrown by Kasher will be of the fastball variety. 2-2 count to Painter. Goff on first, BYU down 10. That's turned on, grounded to first. Trying for the reverse double play, got the one at second. And coming up lame on that is Goff. That's not great. You're already down a catcher, and Goff came up limping as he slid into second and was called out on the force. So one gone. Reaching on the fielder's choice is Painter, as that went 3-6 for the out to retire Goff at second. So just one. Could not turn the two. Would have been tough to do, but first baseman Hartle making the strong call and going to second to get one. Off speed, low and away from Cachero to the pinch hitter, Gavin Taylor. Gavin Taylor batting righty, taking Chipper Beck's spot in the nine hole. And nubs that foul just about 15 feet up the third baseline. So pinch hitter Gavin Taylor in here with one out in the bottom of the ninth. 1-1 the count and 11-1 the score. Tomorrow, doubleheader, 1 o'clock and roughly 4:30, or 30 to 40 minutes after the end of game one. Keone Painter on first, reaching on a fielder's choice. The 1-1 from Cachero to Taylor. Took the barrel off the shoulder and ends up being a called strike on the off-speed. Fastball tops out around 92 for Cachero. A slider and change in the same general neighborhood. High 80s, high 70s, low 80s, and a swing and a strike. Taylor is down. On strikes, and for BYU, that is the 13th strikeout of the day in the box. 12 coming from Reese Dutton, and one now from Hunter Cachero, looking to close this one out. Cougars down to their final out. Two gone here, bottom nine, 11-1 Jayhawks, and Luke Anderson top of the order batting for BYU. Grounds that to short. Slow roller, hard charge, fire to first from Cranford to Hartle, and that'll do it. A 6-3 ground out, and BYU ends its day losing by 10. Final score, 11-1. Kansas wins it. 11 runs, 14 hits for KU. BYU one run on six hits. That's the first of three, and Kansas wins a Big 12 series opening game for the fourth consecutive series and sixth consecutive series overall. We'll see if BYU can get back in and win the series tomorrow. We know we'll now play two tomorrow here in Provo. We'll start post-game coverage for today after this on the new skin, BYU Sports Network.
As the world leader in essential oils, doTERRA's products help athletes around the world maintain the highest level of health and wellness. Our products are responsibly sourced and maximize performance, rest, and recovery for athletes at any level. doTERRA is proud to be the title sponsor of BYU Baseball and to support the student athletes with their health and wellness goals. Learn more about how you can up your health and wellness game at doTERRA.com. doTERRA, pursue what's pure.
This is BYU Radio on 107.9 FM KUNT Randolph. You're listening to Cougar Baseball on BYU.